state of mind. From Sussex to Kent to Newcastle, this is Blue Hens Country, 94.7 WDSD.
It's been 2 weeks since UD has taken the field, but this afternoon, the Delaware Blue Hens return to action, fresh off their bye week, and host a new Hampshire Wildcat team looking to keep their hopes of a 12th straight FCS playoff appearance alive. You're listening to 94.7 WDSD-FM, and I'm Scott Klatskin here in the Value Days broadcast booth, presented by Shell, alongside Matt Janis and on-site producer James Taylor. Down on the field are a pair of mics, Mike Diodati holding the parabolic microphone, picking up field sound for us throughout the day, and Mike Attenrasse reporting from the sideline. And Matt, it's been 2 weeks, a lot of time to think about that loss against Rhode Island, but this Hens team has to bounce back today.
They do indeed. I mean, it just was not good football. It was not fun to watch. It probably wasn't fun to play, I'd imagine, and it was not a good result for this Delaware team because they had started to build some momentum with that thrilling victory over William & Mary. They ran the football so efficiently on the defensive side of the ball. They were flying around. They beat a ranked team that went out and then bounced back by beating New Hampshire last week. That Tribe team's really good, and somehow you go up to Rhode Island and you lay a complete and total egg, and so much of the goodwill that was beginning to surround this program and the anticipation for the future was squashed just a little bit. You've got to get that back. Today is the perfect opportunity to do it. You can end New Hampshire's 11-season playoff streak for all intents and purposes if you hand them a defeat. It's a good football team you're facing. It's a good-sized crowd here today at Delaware Stadium. So many opportunities abound today to get that good feeling, that positive vibe, and that momentum that this program so desperately needs moving forward back in your corner this afternoon.
Delaware won the toss, chose to defer. They will defend the student section end zone on the south side of the stadium. Students still coming into the stadium, but a good crowd on hand already here at Delaware Stadium. This is a rare meeting at Delaware Stadium between these two teams, just the 33rd meeting overall. Delaware leads 20-12 all time. Last time New Hampshire played in Delaware Stadium, it was 2010, a playoff victory for the blue and gold, and playing in that game was the third member of our broadcast team, Michael Attenrasse. Mike, how's it going down on the field?
Yeah, Scott, you talked about it on my way in earlier today. I think I ran into the UNH bus. They asked me for directions on how to get here. I think they forgot. Last time they were here, like you said, was 2010. Delaware prevailed over New Hampshire in a playoff win on a Friday night. Let's hope for a good turnout today from the Delaware team to get another win for the Blue Hens against UNH.
A lot of great games between these two squads, and we are going to get underway in just a moment at Delaware Stadium. The Hens wearing their blue home uniforms with the yellow pants, and New Hampshire coming out with the white road jerseys. Delaware setting up for an onside kick to start. They'll kick it right in the hands of New Hampshire, and the Wildcats will get the football at the 46-yard line of Delaware. Great field position to start. I like the surprise idea of Delaware, but just horribly executed.
Well, the problem was they didn't go surprise onside there. They shifted into an onside alignment. New Hampshire saw it immediately. They shifted with Delaware, and there really was no element of surprise. Wasn't a great kick. Didn't take the high hop, so you didn't have a great opportunity to go get it. But normally when you see a surprise onside, you line up like it's a regular kick. Delaware kind of made that a little obvious the way they angled it, the way they shifted over, and New Hampshire was prepared and ready.
So New Hampshire will get the football first on the Delaware 46-yard line to begin after Delaware with the onside kick recovered by New Hampshire. Goldrich in pistol formation gives the crossing up the gut. He goes. Crossing picks up a couple to the 48-yard line. Let's get to the starters, brought to you by National 5-10 on Main Street, Newark. The place to buy all University of Delaware souvenirs and clothing online at national5and10.com. Crossing the starting running back. Sean Goldrich is the quarterback. Wide receivers Allison Walker and Kelly. Tight end is Powell. Heater, Kennedy, Callis, Kneeler, and Lauderdale are the offensive linemen from left to right. On second and seven for New Hampshire, they'll start with trips to the left side but send Jared Allison in motion to the right. Goldrich pumps, looks for Allison, caught at the 36-yard line and out of bounds, close to a first down. They'll actually mark it at the 37, so 1 yard shy of first. It'll be third down and one. For Delaware defensively, Tinsley, Woodson, Plummer, Hollerman on the defensive line. Kendall Bell, Jackson are your linebackers. Adderley, Watson are your corners, and Jones and Torza at the safety spots. New Hampshire has the football. Third down and one, ball on the 37. This would be huge if Delaware could get a stop to start the game. New Hampshire just 32% conversion rating on third down this season. Trips to the left side with Goldrich in shotgun form on third and one. And they'll go to Crawson, who gets enough to move the sticks, I believe.
I don't know. He fell forward. I think his knee came down, and then he fell forward. And I think they're going to mark him shy in the first down. That was a pretty good job by that middle of the Delaware defensive line. I think Plummer was the guy that got the big push and kind of provided that brick wall. So Delaware gambles to start the game with the onside kick. And now New Hampshire gambles by going for it here on fourth down. Both coaches rolling the dice early.
Fourth and one, ball at the Delaware 37. New Hampshire 6 of 11 on fourth down tries this season. Delaware's defense just 1 of 7. In the pistol, Goldrich to Crawson. This time, for sure, he gets first down yardage before Anthony Jackson trips him up at the 34. That'll move the sticks.
That time that Delaware kind of flooded up front, and New Hampshire knew they were going to have one guy unblocked. It was Anthony Jackson. Jackson there to fill the hole, but just could not quite find the angle, and give some credit to Dalton Cross, and we talked about him, a very shifty runner. Jackson wanted to make sure he didn't miss, because if he did, Crossen scores a touchdown, but it allowed UNH to keep the offense on the field.
2 minutes into this football game, New Hampshire driving, first and 10 at the Delaware 33-yard line. Goldrich, play action for New Hampshire all day, and Goldrich going to tuck, has some room, and a shoestring tackle made by Blaine Woodson stops Goldrich at the 26-yard line. There was a whole lot of green ahead of Goldrich if Woodson didn't trip him up.
That's a good sign for New Hampshire. Of course, Goldrich missing 3 games of that high ankle sprain. Did not run the football very often last week against William & Mary. Gets involved early here. They had double coverage on each outside wide receiver, and they had the seam taken away, but Goldrich tucked it immediately.
4 wide receivers for New Hampshire on second down and 3, 6 yards away from the red zone. Goldrich, shotgun snap, looking to the left. Quick throw is caught at the 25, at the 20, and cutting back is the New Hampshire wide receiver inside the 15. It's Neil O'Connor, the redshirt freshman, his 7th catch this season, and another first down for this fast-moving Wildcats offense.
Had a little numbers game there. Receiver screen on the outside. It's 2-on-2. Pretty good job by Ray Jones to avoid the block. But because Jones had to try to make somebody miss just to get to the ball carrier, Jones missed the tackle. Rare miss stop. And a good job by O'Connor to elude him.
New Hampshire in the red zone, 4th in the CAA, and a red zone scoring, 17-22 this season. Empty backfield for Goldrich, trips to the right side, ball on the far side, left hash. 1st and 10 for the 14. He drops the snap, Goldrich just dives on it, and it'll be a big loss, big help for the Delaware Blue Hens defense as New Hampshire moved back about 7-8 yards.
I think that snap might have come early, Scott. I'm not really sure, because it seemed like it was pretty good placement, and there was a great push off the line of scrimmage from the New Hampshire offensive line, so I think the snatter was just a tad premature there. Watch the replay. That's exactly what happened. It bounced right off the chest of Goldrich. An alert play by the quarterback to fall on top of it, but a good break for Delaware as UNH now behind the sticks.
Goldrich back in shotgun form on second down and 17 now from the Delaware 21-yard line. First possession of the game for New Hampshire. No score. Play action, Goldrich, pocket collapsing, and a lot of blue. Goldrich gets away from several would-be sackers and gets back to the 20-yard line. A pickup of 1, David Tinsley with the tackle eventually, but a nice shifty move by Goldrich to avoid the sack.
I tell you what, though, Vince Hollerman just ate Curtis Neeler's lunch that time, pushed him into the backfield and collapsed that pocket from the outside. That forced Goldrich to immediately tuck. Didn't have any opportunity to survey the field whatsoever, and that's a successful play. Keeps him in third and long.
Trips to the right side on third and 16, ball in the Delaware 20. They'll send Allison in motion from right to left. And Goldrich wants to throw the football, does so. Middle of the field, the tight end is there to make the catch, shy of the first down marker at the 7-yard line. It was Nasir Adderley who wrapped him up and brought him down.
And how many times have we said all season long, Adderley, such a sure tackler, had a little bit of help from the safety over the top as well. Ryan Torza knew where the sticks were, but New Hampshire, they love going for it in their CAA games, including that fourth down conversion earlier. They are now 6 of 11 on fourth down. They're bad on third down. They're great on fourth.
And Delaware has not been able to stop offensive teams on fourth down. 7 of 8 are the Hens' opponents. Fourth down and 3 from the Delaware 7. Bunch to the right side. Goldrich, shotgun snap, looking right, throwing right. It's caught. And it's enough for the first down at the 3. Jared Allison, his 13th catch of the season. And another fourth down pickup for the Wildcats. Will be first and goal to go from the three.
Just a little stick route there from Allison coming out of the backfield, circled into the center of the field, stopped right around the three. Pretty good throw by Goldridge. Delaware brought pressure, and they had the outside covered, but just left vulnerable in the middle of the field, and Goldridge delivered a strike.
Now Goldridge spreading out his offense, takes a shotgun snap, gives it to Carlson. Carlson running right and dives into the end zone with Charles Bell on his leg. Carlson gets across the goal line and scores first for New Hampshire. It's 6-0 Wildcats.
Very deflating start for Delaware. They gamble with the onside kick. It does not work. It sets New Hampshire up with a short field. The Delaware defense responds, though. They get two third down stops, but on third and long, both times they allow New Hampshire to get chunk yardage and set up fourth and shorts. UNH stays on the field. That's something that this New Hampshire offense does. They challenge you for a full four downs once they get on your side of the field.
Reese Holes, Christian Breda with the PAT. That's through. And a 7-0 lead to start the game for New Hampshire. That's your PNC Bank timeout score with 9:10 left in quarter number one. Delaware will get the football for the first time when we return.
The International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers Local 313 features the best trained and most skilled and productive electricians in the entire state of Delaware and Cecil County, Maryland. Our electrical contractors are ready to provide you the most competitive and all-inclusive quote for your next electrical project. Call 302-328-0773 today or visit IBEW313.org to get a list of electrical contractors who will provide you with the unsurpassed electrical service you require and deserve.
Brought to you by State Farm. No matter where you are in life.
The beloved annual Youth Cheer Day event at Delaware Stadium is back for another year. Don't wait until the last minute. Event registration is open and filling quickly for the Delaware football home finale on Saturday, November 14th. No cheerleading experience needed. Registration includes a pregame clinic with the Delaware cheerleaders, followed by an on-field halftime performance for all to enjoy. For details and to register, visit BlueHens.com.
New Hampshire leads 7-0 over Delaware on their first drive of the day. Michael Adnarase down on the sideline had a good view of things. What'd you see?
Guys, when talking about defense, you always want to stress third down percentage. How many times can we get stops on third down? Now, when talking about third down percentage, Delaware's defense is third in the CAA. Very good on getting off the field on third down. Fourth down is what kills us. This season so far, teams have gone for on fourth down against us seven times. They've completed six. Those two on that drive just makes an 8 out of 9. We got to find some way to get off the field on fourth down. That's so deflating when it comes to defense.
And New Hampshire's not afraid to go for it on fourth down when they get the football on your side of the field. They understand it's a percentage game at that point. If you can get yourself into a fourth down and less than five, they don't even need it to be fourth and one or two. That second fourth down conversion was a long three, but you got that experienced quarterback Goldridge, and Sean McDonald trusts some good play call from Ryan Carty as well.
Morgan Elman kicks it off to Ray Jones. Far side of the field, he has it to 10, now 15, 20. Speeds to the 25-yard line, and he's brought down by Donald Goldridge, the fullback on the New Hampshire offensive side. Let's get to the starters for Delaware again, brought to you by National 5 and 10. Joe Walker is your quarterback. Thomas Jefferson at the running back position. Deontay Cherry back at full strength. He'll join Jamie Jarman and Vinny Papali as the wide receivers. Brandon Whaley is the tight end offensive line. Drake Trump, Will Lewis shaking off an injury last week. Brody Kern banged up a bit, used the bye week to get healthy. Connor Bozick and Ben Curtis at the right tackle spot. 9:05 on the first quarter clock in Delaware will get the football for the first time, down by 7, and they'll start at their own 25. In shotgun form is Joe Walker, looking to the left side, caught by Cherry, and he tripped as he tried to get up the field. He just tripped over his own feet there, as closing in on him was Daniel Rowe, but nobody touched him.
Well-designed play. Cherry lines up in the backfield. They move him in motion right before the snap of the football. He flanks the defense. It's a good throw from Walker. He pretty much hit him in stride. If Cherry catches it, it's 5 or 6 yards. It's those high percentage throws Delaware's looking for. He falls down. All of a sudden, it's -2. You're behind the sticks.
But those are the passes, like you said, Matt, that you want to see Joe Walker making, getting some easy yardage. Some movement before the play.
Prior to snap, offside. 90, defense, 5 yards, second down.
That's Rashid Armin, the senior from Sheeps Head Bay High School in Brooklyn, and that gets you some yardage back.
Not sure what Armand's doing. He's right in front of the football. Wasn't even that much of a hard count from Walker, and he just jumped straight into the center. That was a weird one.
Second down and 7 after the penalty. Walker under center. Single back is Thomas Jefferson. 3 wide receivers. Cherry to the near side left. They'll go to Jefferson. He cuts it back at the 30. Another cut at the 35 to the 40-yard line. Dragging the defender down at the 43-yard line. Thomas Jefferson with a hard run for a first down pickup. Cam Shorey made the stop.
And not only a hard run, Scott, but a zigzagging run. He went left and cut back right and one more time against the grain to the left. We talked about Delaware's offensive line, how good it has been. That time they let two guys untouched in the backfield, and Jefferson made them both miss. This kid is really starting to turn into the type of back that you're going to be talking about for a lot of years on this campus.
Owen Tyler in the game now. He slid out to the left side on first and 10 from the 43. Jefferson running hard again, spinning, and getting to the 46-yard line, a pickup of 4 on first down. Let's get to the starters defensively for New Hampshire. Cam Shorey, Rashid Armand, Julian Turner, and Jawan Horton as a defensive line that has really been dominant in CAA play this season. Anderson is in the game, and McNally replaces Devon Shillette as a starting linebacker. Corners, DeAndre Moss are at those positions, the safeties, Rowe, Knudsen, and Edmund.
And they really trust those linebackers to cover ground, but they have had some issues filling the holes against the run, as we've seen Jefferson take advantage of early.
Bunch trips to the left side, now an empty backfield. Walker, screen pass, dropped by Jamie Jarman, and again, Delaware dropping passes. Walker slinging it, again, a little bit maybe too hot for Jarman, but that's certainly a catchable ball.
Yeah, you got to catch that football. I mean, I understand what you're saying, and you're right, and Walker's had some issues on that at times this year. You got to throw a catchable football, but in that spot, you're trying to beat the defense to the outside. He's got to throw that one with some velocity. It hits Jarman perfectly in the hands. It's a guy that just doesn't have a lot of reps at wide receiver, and I think he's going to have to work on that.
Now 3rd and 7 for Delaware from their own 46-yard line. 7:02, first quarter. Walker dropping back to throw. Has a man caught. There's Cherry, and enough for the first down to New Hampshire territory inside the 45. Down at the 44 he goes. Second first down of this drive. Good to have Deontay back.
Yeah, what happened that time, a good play design from Sean Devine. They ran vertical routes. Whaley ran a seam down the field from his tight end position. Papali ran the other's corner off, and the other safety went with him. And then Cherry came across the field from the left side of the formation all the way over the center, and there was just all types of open space in that New Hampshire zone. Really well-designed play from Delaware.
Hands go to tight end. Tackle was made by Ryan Farrell on that last play after they pick up the first down at the New Hampshire 44. Play action. Walker sets his feet, throws it down the field, looking for Jarman, overthrows his target, but a flag is thrown. Casey DeAndre was holding our receiver. And that's going to go against the Wildcats.
Yeah, you could pick your poison there. It could be holder, pass interference. They'll go PI, which gets you an extra 5 yards, a 15-yarder.
Pass interference. Defense, number 28. 15 yards from the original line of scrimmage. First down.
He was beat immediately, completely fooled by that play call from Delaware. Sean Devine going to the first down throw. They had some success on the ground early in this series. That sets up the play action opportunity. He was beat. He held. Then once the ball was in the air, he continued to hold, which turns it into PI. Walker threw it up where it was catchable, gave Jarman a chance, and Delaware's in business.
And how about Jamie Jarman beating CAA All-Conference cornerback Casey DeAndre? First carry of the day for Kareem Williams as he runs to the far right side. Hit hard as he gets to the New Hampshire sideline. Pickup of 2 on first down. 6:15. First quarter action. New Hampshire up 7-0. This is the first possession of the day for the Hens. And we're already 5 plays and 23 yards into it.
Hens got squeezed on that spot. They only gave him a yard to the 28. And if he went out of bounds at the 28-yard line, then that was a late hit because the hit came up near the 27. If you're going to say he went out at the 28, then that should have been 15 more for Delaware. But Hens to the air maybe here.
Walker is in shotgun form, rolling to the right side, design QB run, and here goes Walker, pushed by DeAndre, out of bounds, just shy of the first down marker at the 21. It'll be third down and short for the Hens.
I like it. They spread the field that time, and it looked like Walker, when he got the snap, was looking left, looked off that safety, and then immediately a tuck and run. That's a quarterback design run, kind of a power sweep to the right side. You've got to get Walker back involved in the running attack. He was there in the first half against Rhode Island, in the first half against William & Mary early in the season. He's been quiet, though, lately in that area. It adds another dimension to this offense.
Walker in shotgun form. Now Jefferson, the back to his left. Third down and two from the 21. Tyler goes in motion from right to left. High snap. Walker with a QB read. Gets it to Jefferson, stumbling past the 15-yard line. And first down pickup for Thomas Jefferson. Hens inside the red zone. It'll be first and 10.
And that's what happens there. You run that quarterback the previous play, and then all of a sudden the end has to freeze and make sure that Walker's not going to keep it. Mike Borieski that time was completely frozen, gave Jefferson the step he needed to gain the edge, and that's pretty much all Thomas Jefferson needs. Probably a half step is enough with his ability to kind of find that open space. Downhill runner when he needs to be, ran downhill that time, and the Hens really an impressive drive after a tough start to this football game.
Riley Angeline comes in on first and 10 from the Delaware 14. In motion goes Williams. Walker going to roll out. Has Jefferson caught at the 10. One man to meet. He does so. And into the end zone. No, they'll call him down at the 1. Thomas Jefferson spun, reached for the goal line, but will be marked down at the 1. What a move by Thomas Jefferson to even make it close. But the Hens the chance to punch it in first and goal to go from three feet away.
And they ran play action that time. Walker rolling to the right. And then a good little route from Jefferson as they fake to the tight end moving to the left. Jefferson goes to the flat. Walker hits him immediately. No hesitation whatsoever.
Walker will go under center. Two backs behind him. It'll be Jefferson, and he finishes the drive. Delaware marches down the field on their first possession and gets a score with Thomas Jefferson.
Looks like a completely different offense, not only from the mess that was Rhode Island, but even from the game against William and Mary the week prior, where Delaware looked very impressive on the offensive side. That was a more balanced attack. They actually threw the ball for 21 yards. They got 15 more on a penalty, pass interference on a pass play. Balance there into the Delaware offense.
Frank Rago's PAT is up and no good. First miss of the season on extra point from Frank Rago. So Delaware can't tie the score, but they look good on offense on their very first drive of the day. Your PNC Bank timeout score, New Hampshire 7, Delaware 6, 4-12, first quarter action.
People's Plaza and Blue Hens Football are teaming up for the 2015 season. Stop into any one of the 85 businesses in People's Plaza and register to be the People's Plaza Fan of the Game.
University of Delaware Athletics partner PNC Bank recognizes two top athletes today. The PNC Bank Student Athlete of the Week Award recognizes student athletes who display well-rounded achievement through leadership in the classroom, in the community, and in competition. We're proud to recognize the following PNC Bank Student Athlete Achievers: Coley Ricky from women's lacrosse and Ryan Torza from football. Let's join our partner PNC Bank in a round of applause for these student scholars who exemplify leadership in education, community service, and athletics.
Fans, check out the video board as you can be today's National 5 and 10 Fan of the Game. National 5 and 10 Fan Cam is searching the stands for the best Blue Hens. Make some noise if you see with your Blue Hens gear. And remember, you can get all your Blue Hens gear at National 5 and 10 in Newark.
Delaware goes 10 plays, 75 yards, and finds the answer in 4 minutes and 53 seconds on the game clock. Can't make the PAT, so New Hampshire with a lead 7-6, 4-12 in the first quarter. I'm Scott Klaskin alongside Matt Janis, Michael Attenrause on the sideline. I want to thank Brandywine Electronics for our partnership and all the sweet gear they provide for us. Last game, we debuted the new Clover 26-inch True Parabolic Disc with brand new custom pickup mic. BEL is one of only five dealers authorized to sell and rent this new exciting product. For more information on beefing up your broadcast, contact our friends at Brandywine Electronics at BEL.com. Delaware will kick off for the second time today as they deferred after winning the coin toss. Their first try was an onside kick that went right into the hands of Mike Kelly. I would assume they'll boot this one away to Dalton Crossan this time around.
Sure hope so. Although that would be the ultimate riverboat gamble, wouldn't it, to double down?
Ball is in the air. It is short. Crossan will run to get it and catch it at the 15-yard line. Now at the 20, making a move at the 25, cutting it at the 30-yard line. Stiff arm and out of bounds. He goes. Ray Jones was there to make the push out at the 32-yard line. So New Hampshire's second timeout on offense, they'll at least start on their side of the field.
No surprise by that, though. One of the big strengths for this Delaware team all season, and only one of the things they take great pride in, has been their kick coverage. With the exception of that one kickoff return against William and Mary, it has been exquisite all year. They go sky kick there. They put that one high in the air. They angled it towards the sideline. I know Crossan certainly is somebody you don't want to trifle with, but at the same time, that should be a strength on a strength. They go onside to avoid it the first time, and that time they go sky kick. You still give UNH pretty good field position.
Worth noting, Kevin McLaughlin back in as the guy that handles kickoffs. He had missed a couple weeks, but he is healthy. Donald Goodrich in as the running back. Goldrich, design QB keep, will go up the gut, running into Simba Guashavano and a couple other defensive linemen as he gets to the 36-yard line. Pick up a 4 on first down. Larry Spears also in on the tackle.
Talked about it a little bit in the pregame show, Scotty. He just did not look sure of himself last week against William & Mary. He missed those 3 weeks, but not only was he out of game action for 3 weeks, he did not practice until the Wednesday before that William & Mary game. So there was a lot of rust he had to shake off in the first half. They tried to avoid running him. Goldridge, we're talking about. Well, he's been running the football early in this one.
Second down and 6 for New Hampshire from their own 36. Goldridge going to throw quick out, and it's caught, staying in bounds momentarily at the 39 as Amici Walker, but Simaguashavano was in on coverage. It'll be third down and about 3 for the Wildcats.
They come in waves, don't they? I mean, it's just unbelievable how many bodies flow to that football. Adderley missed him at first, but Guashavano there to clean up. There's always a second helper around for these Hens. They flow to the football, gang tackle, great effort, guys. And Sean McDonald talked about it this week. The biggest difference in Delaware's defense is what they've done up front. The second biggest difference is the way they flow to the football in bunches.
It'll be third down and 2 for New Hampshire. New Hampshire 0 of 2 on third downs, 2 of 2 on fourth downs in today's game. Under 3 minutes, first quarter. Goldrich on the run, throwing, and it's caught for a first down and more. Amici Walker into Delaware territory at the 48-yard line. Ray Jones with the push out, and New Hampshire moves the chain.
Boy, Dave Brock was all over the official pre-snap that time. He thought New Hampshire had lined up illegally. He didn't think they had the 7 on the line of scrimmage. They had motion to the far side of the field. The motion man came back towards the middle, and they snuck the slot receiver to the sideline. Good throw from Goldrich to hit him in stride.
Ball now on the far side, hats for Goldrich. Ball at the Delaware 47. He'll go to Crawson again. Crawson met by several blue jerseys. In there first was Charles Bell. Also in the mix, Vince Hollerman. But you're absolutely right, Matt. Every time there's a play, Blue Hens players swarming all over the ball carrier.
I mean, they're physical. There's no doubt about that. I mean, they've beaten Villanova up. They've beaten William & Mary up this season. You're going to feel the effects of playing Delaware for a couple weeks afterwards. And then there's effort. They don't quit on plays, which is just a real testament to where they were a year ago to where they are now.
New Hampshire dual backs now in motion. Goes Allison on second down and 7. Pumping Goldrich, throwing Goldrich, and making the tackle is Larry Spears after the catch was made at the 44-yard line. Spears with a hard hit on Amici Walker, the freshman who's been very active on this drive. Now third and long for the Wildcats, 3rd and 7 from the Hens 44.
A good piece of officiating there because Spears made the tackle and then the receiver popped up immediately and Charles Bell did not know he was down and hit him, but the whistle did not blow immediately, so the official did not throw the flag. Break there for Delaware, but a good piece of officiating. Bell had no way of knowing.
Balance set for New Hampshire. 2 on each side of Goldrich in shotgun form on 3rd and 7. In motion goes Allison, now trips to the left. In the slot's the tight end. Goldrich looking right, diving is Simba Guashavano, and he picks it off. Vince Hollerman pressured Goldrich into throwing early, and Simba with his first INT of the year.
Well, Hollerman got there. I think Charles Bell came in as well from a blitz, delayed blitz there at the center, and just got the bottom of Goldrich's body. And as a result, Goldrich just wanted no part of being in there. When you're coming back from an ankle injury, you're a little bit hesitant to take shots low. And as a result, he threw that one blindly. He threw it sooner than he wanted to before his receiver came out of the break. Guashavano knew a blitz was on and knew he had the opportunity to jump the route, saw that Goldrich was ready to pull the trigger early, just really well executed across the board from the Hens D.
Third interception of the year for the Hens defense. The takeaway gives it to Delaware. 1:11. First quarter action on the sweep. It's Williams running wide to the right side, and he's pushed out at the 44. Hens down 7-6. 1:06 left in quarter number one. What a play. What a dive that was by Simba Guashavano to go full extension and get the INT.
Yeah, I mean, he read it, and that's part of the battle, but then you also have to physically be able to go get the football. Guashavano with that closing speed, and then you're right, full extension on the dive, got his arms underneath and kind of cradled that football as he rolled his body to protect it.
Three wide receivers on second down and five for the Delaware 44-yard line. Single back is Williams. Williams will get it for the second straight time. Not as much that time. Cam Shorey tried to strip it away before he made the tackle at the line of scrimmage. Ball did not pop loose, and it's going to be third down and five, maybe six. Give Williams minus one on that play.
Oh, you're not kidding. That's a big boy, big hit, and then second guy coming in to try to go for the football. New Hampshire doing some gang tackling of their own here. Hens do not have to run another play in the third quarter, in the first quarter, if they don't want to. And it kind of looks like Delaware is content to take a one-point deficit, but a little momentum with them into the second period.
Play clock not started. Game clock at 7-6, and they'll let it tick off. Delaware will flip sides of the field, and second quarter action coming up in just a moment. 7-6 is the score after one. That's your PNC Bank timeout score. We'll take a break on 94.7 WDSD.
University of Delaware alumni are invited to relive the good old days with the Hens Homecoming Game Pack. Grab your fellow alums, family, or friends and buy the $50 Hens Homecoming Game Pack today. Four game tickets and access to the Delaware Beer Garden on game day included. Why wait until the last minute to celebrate the Delaware blue and gold on homecoming? Visit bluehens.com/homecoming today to secure your homecoming game day experience.
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium. I'm Scott Klatskin alongside Matt Janis. Michael Latinarasse down on the field with Mike Diodati with the field sound. James Taylor, our on-site producer. After one, New Hampshire 7, Delaware 6. Delaware with the football now. New Hampshire was able to score on their first possession. Delaware was able to do so as well, but Frank Rago missed the PAT. So the Hens down by one right now. And as I look down on the field, I'm seeing a lot of Blue Hens faithful in the crowd today. Michael Latinarasse is down on the sideline. What's the view like from down there?
It is beautiful. You know, when I was getting recruited as a freshman in 2007, one of the recruiting highlights was the crowd. We would stack the crowd, the tub, with 22,000 faithful, and that's what it feels like right now. It feels like back in the day when I was playing here, guys.
I mean, they're here to cheer you on from the sideline. I think maybe that might be it. Matt, after 15 minutes of action, Delaware sticking right with New Hampshire, and they get a takeaway on defense, a chance to take the lead on this drive.
They tried the onside kick to start the football game. It doesn't work. You're only down a point, and you got the ball with pretty good field position after one quarter. You will take that if you're UD. Great response on both sides of the ball. The offense has played well. The defense stiffened after some early adversity.
Five wide to start quarter number two for Delaware. Walker. Back to throw. Steps up in the pocket. Now will have to get loose. He does at the 45, 50, 45, and right into a New Hampshire defender at the 46-yard line goes Joe Walker. Big pickup on third down and six for Joe. A 14-yard gain and a first down for the Hens.
You know, that was great. Sean McDonald just fired his headset off his head that time. So frustrated. Got pressure from the edge. Kind of had Walker bottled up, but Joe did a good job to stay with it. He tried to stick with his read. He wanted to throw that football, which is a good step in the maturation process of Walker, but then when an escape valve opened up, he popped to the outside, and UNH had nobody to account for the Delaware quarterback.
Single back is Williams in New Hampshire territory. First down and 10. Hens down by one. Some movement, but getting back in time are the defensive linemen of New Hampshire. Walker going to give to Williams. Sprinting to the outside left. Picks up close to a first down. A 9-yard gain for Kareem Williams on first and 10 from the 43.
That's another example of what we were talking about in the open. Really poor angle that time from the safety, Hayden Knudsen, as he came from the backside, had an opportunity one-on-one with Williams to stop him for a 3-yard pickup, just was fooled by Williams' speed. Kareem has that extra burst that you're not expecting. Williams beat him wide, couldn't quite free himself from Knudsen all the way, but still, instead of a 3 or 4 yard pickup, he gets 9, and now the whole playbook open for Sean Devine here on second and short and plus territory.
Just a yard to pick up the first. In motion goes the tight end Tyler from the New Hampshire 33, and they'll go conservative as Williams goes right up the gut, picks up the first down to the 30, a gain of three, and another first down for Delaware.
Not going to mess around with it, and why would you? You're a line of scrimmage football team. You're a downhill club. You've got a little bit of momentum going through the passing attack, but let's not go overboard with it. Let's make sure we maintain our identity and the thought process of the coaching staff there. Do what you do best, a downhill run. Nice job by Williams. Made a man miss at the line of scrimmage and fell forward to move the pile for an extra yard or two.
Angeline in as a tight end. Two wide receivers to the near side. Walker goes in shotgun form with Williams to his left. Angeline goes in motion on first and 10 from the New Hampshire 30. They'll give it to the running back Williams. Hurdles a defender and is dropped in midair. Dangerous play as he gets to the 25-yard line. Hayden Knudsen, the senior, with the stop.
And New Hampshire's a little, I think, right back on their heels because they wanted to play downhill. They were keyed up and ready to try to flood the box and stop the run. Delaware able to get some passing plays that were positive on that first drive. Now as New Hampshire playing back just a tad, and then from Mike Otrazay on the sideline, says, you know, Joe Walker also using the hard count to keep New Hampshire from getting any type of a jump off the line of scrimmage, which just makes that Delaware offensive line so much more effective.
Walker will go under center on second down and 5. And he'll go bootleg. Play action, pumping. He wants to throw to his tight end. It's Angeline caught. They'll lose a yard. Good coverage that time from Daniel Rowe, who was all over Riley Angeline, who popped out to help Joe Walker, who was being chased.
You're right, but it was a freak of nature play by Ryan Farrell that time. Farrell came on the end. He bumped Angeline, completely stopped his progress, then came off of Angeline and went right after Joe Walker. And good job, though, by Joe Walker not to panic. He held on to that football. He knew how much time he had before Farrell would arrive. He allowed Angeline to clear and threw a ball that only his tight end could get. If Angeline breaks a tackle, great. If not, you get back to the line of scrimmage.
Hens have it third down and 6 now. Walker now 4 of 5 through the air, dropping back. Pocket collapses. Walker wants to run with it but cannot. Cam Shorey with a sack, his 6th of the season. He's 3rd in the CAA. And it'll be 4th down for Delaware.
And that's going to happen. You're going to give up some sacks. Julian Turner has to go out of the game here. He lost his helmet. And I would not be surprised. Well, what do I know? I was going to say I would not be surprised if Delaware goes for it. I am very surprised that the Hens are going to try a long field goal here from 45 yards out. You've already missed an extra point. You've struggled on these long attempts so far this season. But Dave Brock has confidence in his kicker.
This will be middle of the field, 45 yards for Frank Rigo. He missed twice against Rhode Island. Anderson will hold. Fortunato will snap on 4th down and 8. Ball is in the air from Frank Rigo. Will it have enough? It will not. Just shy of the goalpost, and that's another miss, 3 in a row from Frank Rigo out on the PAT, and he's not made a kick in quite some time. 7-6 is the count. New Hampshire on top. And we'll take a timeout. That's your PNC Bank timeout score with 10:53 remaining in quarter number 2.
We want to invite you to join us for the Blue Hens Football Coaches Show every Wednesday night at 7 p.m. at Klondike Kate's.
So join us at the heart of Main Street or listen at 94.7 WDSD and by downloading the iHeartRadio mobile app. And as always,
go Hens!
Fans, today's Buffalo Wild Wings winning row is Section M, Row F. That's Section M, Row F. Everyone in that row wins a $20 gift card. Come on, some Buffalo Wild Wings. Be sure to visit their location in Newark on South Main Street after the game or join us at any of our other locations statewide. Voted Best Wings and Best Sports Bar by both Delaware Today Magazine and the News Journal. Buffalo Wild Wings, the place to be for wings, beer, and sports.
N53 remaining in the second quarter. New Hampshire will get the football after Frank Rigo misses from 45 yards. That's his 3rd miss of the year from the exact distance of 45 yards. It was 4th down and not easy for Delaware, but I would have loved a little bit more aggression on the offensive side.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised that Delaware tries to field goal, as I alluded to before the kick. That's, I think, right at the edge of Frank Rago's range, and as we found out, it's a little bit beyond his range. It just, you know, Delaware has been such an attacking mode offensively in the first 2 years of the Brock era. They've gone away from that here lately.
New Hampshire goes play action, big package, and Goldrick's going to be brought down by David Tinsley. As Goldrick, the quarterback, tried to elude our senior captain, but could not. It'll be second down and 13 for New Hampshire.
My apologies there, Scott. Didn't mean to go long, but New Hampshire thought they had something that time. They went heavy package, and they came out of an immediate timeout with a quick snap, thinking that they could get Delaware before they identified. They tried play action. They snuck the tight end up the seam, and they ran the running back on a wheel route all the way down the far sideline, but Tinsley's penetration blew the play up.
It'll be second down and 13 after Tinsley gets his fourth sack of the season. Goldrich wants to throw, looking right. Pocket closes. Now Goldrich going to try to run with it. Still pumping, looking for an open man. Has none at the 30. He'll step out of bounds. Justin Watson was near. David Tinsley giving chase once again. Now Tinsley a little slow to get up at that 30-yard line.
He took a shot late in the play from Austin Henner, the senior offensive lineman for New Hampshire. Right near the sideline. Tinsley still down on one knee as the training staff gets over to attend to him for Delaware. That was a really good job by the Hens defensive line. Must rush that time. Not get too far up the field. Goldridge is looking for scrambling lanes between the tackles. He's a guy that likes to climb the pocket, and if there's an avenue, he'll take it. If the seam presents itself, he will tuck and run right between the tackles. He seems a little less comfortable running wide. Not sure if it's maybe that ankle that's still a bit gimpy and he doesn't feel like he has the speed, or if that's just not a big part of his game. We haven't seen enough of UNH over the years to really know him inside and out, but he did not look nearly as comfortable running wide as he does up the middle.
Cam Kitchen, the true freshman from Lawrenceville, will check in for David Tinsley on third and 7 for New Hampshire. Trips go to the right side. Kion Taylor split to the left. Dalton Crossan is the running back. Goldrich in shotgun form takes the snap. Here's Goldrich. Slings it across the field. Catch is made, but so is a tackle by Nasir Adderley, wrapping up the wide receiver Allison at the 35, shy of the first down marker.
Sean McDonald said that he thought the biggest difference for Delaware defensively was their defensive line this year. I personally feel the biggest difference is tackling. They do not miss their opportunities in space, and perhaps nobody has personified that better than Nasir Adderley. He just does not miss the stop. They have been running outs on him all year long, and he has been such a sure tackler. You cannot throw it short of the sticks on third down unless you're prepared to go for it on fourth if you want to keep your offense out there against UD.
New Hampshire going to punt the football. Christian Breida is back to punt it. Deontay Cherry for the Hens back to return, waving his arms as the ball bounces at the 30-yard line. Back to the 25, now 22 as it rolls. Delaware gets a defensive stop, and they'll get the football back after a 44-yard punt. No return. And Delaware will start this drive on the 21-yard line. Good to see Deontay Cherry back as the punt returner for the Hens. He's healthy, was held out of several games after injuring himself against Villanova. He's got two catches for 8 yards today. Thomas Jefferson with a catch for 13 yards. Riley Angeline with a catch for negative 1 yards. But Joe Walker, 4 of 5, 20 yards, not a whole lot of yardage. But Matt, I know you wanted to see him be high efficiency, high percentage in this game, and you're getting that so far.
Well, you got the 20 yards on that first drive, and then you got 15 on the pass interference as well. You have made New Hampshire's defense at least pay attention to the passing game. You had some shots in play action. You got to make sure you stick with trying them, though.
Walker will go under center with Jefferson as the back. First and 10 at the Delaware 21, and a good defensive effort. Tackling in space by Hayden Knudsen as Jefferson tried to turn up the field, could not. The senior safety came up and made the tackle.
But again, that's a safety making a stop in the backfield, and that's exactly what we're talking about, Scott. If New Hampshire does not think that you are willing to throw the ball on first down, and a couple of shots on that opening drive evidently has not been enough to sell this New Hampshire defense, it's going to be tough to run the football early in early down situations. There's just too many bodies up near the line of scrimmage, too many guys to block.
Negative 2 on that play. New Hampshire leads 7-6. Second down and 12 and some movement.
All start. 81. Offense. 5 yards. Second down.
And that's Brandon Whaley, the tight end, with some movement. So Delaware, run play for minus 2 and now a penalty, minus 5. Making it difficult for themselves as they get their first drive of the second quarter.
Got to be smart with the football here, though, now, Scott. I mean, certainly you don't want to quit on the possession. It's only second down. They can't afford to give New Hampshire a short field here. You've got to protect the football first and foremost.
Walker will go in shotgun form. Near side hash. Jefferson with a fake give to him. It'll be Walker actually keeping himself on the QB choice. He gets up to the 17-yard line. Had to try to shake a couple of defenders and could not. Daniel Rowe came in and made the tackle. It's going to be third and long for Delaware, 14 to go, with the ball on their own 17.
Rowe made the stop, but DeAndre came up again. A cornerback up near the line of scrimmage. You're just not forcing New Hampshire to defend the pass. You thought maybe you would accomplish that with those first drive throws. And on that second possession, I think New Hampshire was a little bit more hesitant to flow everybody near the line of scrimmage, but they have recommitted to it here on this drive. Now, this is a passing situation, so everything's different here on third and very long.
Just under 7 minutes left in the first half. Walker on third and 14, takes the snap, steps up, throws. Terry nearly made a one-handed catch, but just a little too wide for Deontay. Even if he caught the football, he would have 11 more yards to go to pick up the first down. An incomplete pass, and we'll see Eric Anderson for the first time today.
Yeah, it's just a field position play. High percentage pass to try to get Walker a little bit of confidence. He's just a little too far out in front of that toss with Cherry. Cherry against the grain there. Had four bodies he was going to have to weave his way through. He had no chance to pick up the first down. You'd like to see that pass get completed, though. It should have been.
Casey DeAndre back to return. Dangerous return man for New Hampshire. Anderson gets this one away on fourth down and 14. It takes a Delaware bounce. Now bounces backwards New Hampshire's way. And it'll be down at the 50-yard line. A 33-yard punt for Eric Anderson. No return. New Hampshire leads 7-6 with 6:41 remaining. That's your PNC Bank timeout score. We'll take a break from Delaware Stadium.
12 and younger, join the fun and become a future Hens Club member today. Presented by St. Francis Healthcare. Visit bluehens.com/FH Club for details.
Grotto Pizza, the official pizza of Delaware Athletics and in a Delaware tradition for over 50 years, presents today's Grotto Pizza seat upgrade of the game. These lucky fans were upgraded to box seats, compliments of Grotto Pizza. Be sure to stop by the concession stands during the game and get your legendary taste. Grotto Pizza, Delaware's favorite pizza since 1960. Bato's Italian Sausage is a proud partner of the Blue Hens. Nothing goes better with football game than the delicious taste of a Bato's Italian Sausage Sandwich. Head to concessions to get one now. Also found in your local supermarket. Bato's Italian Sausage. Sweet or hot, they hit the spot.
Now. Country, 94.7 WDSD.
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium, where our restaurant of the week is Duck Donuts on Main Street in Newark, serving up warm, delicious, and made-to-order donuts and premium coffee daily. These donuts are made to order while you watch, and you pick the toppings and coatings. The combinations are endless. Or try a specialty donut like the delicious orange creamsicle and their famous maple bacon. See what everyone's talking about, the most delicious donuts you'll find. Head to Duck Donuts on Main Street in Newark with free parking, or visit duckdonuts.com. New Hampshire, first and 10. From the 50, screen pass is deflected. Looked like Grant Roberts got a piece of it. His first pass deflection of the year. And it'll be second and 10 for UNH.
Again, pressure from the center of that Delaware defensive line. The tackle's doing a really pretty good job since that initial possession. The screen coming in, and it was red. And as a result, just kind of stopping on a dime by Roberts, getting his hands up in the passing lane and recognizing that that's a middle screen, now jumping to the outside. Well done.
New Hampshire and the Wildcat. Goldrich split out to the far right side. Trevor Knight in as the quarterback. They'll give it to the QB. He'll keep it himself, and he is drilled by Charles Bell. Trevor Knight meets the seventh leading tackler in the CAA. Pounded to the turf. And it'll be third down and 6 for the Wildcat. 6:18 left to go in the first half. New Hampshire with a one-point lead, 7-6. With the football at the Delaware 46-yard line. And another third down for the Wildcats. They're 1 of 5 today converting on third down.
Boy, New Hampshire's always got a trick ready and waiting, don't they?
Every year, every team that goes out there, we've seen a quarterback at some point split out, I think. It was Goldrich that time. Now he's back at the QB spot in shotgun form. Henshaw and blitz. Pressure comes. Bell's picked up. Goldrich, though, is brought down by Simba Guashavanu. What an afternoon he's having. An interception and now a tackle for loss. Or maybe getting back to the line of scrimmage was Goldrich. But the punt unit comes out for UNA.
Yeah, I think he'll get his credit for a sack on that one. It looks like a half-yard loss, tomato, tomato, as they say. Either way, great push again. This time it was from the defensive ends. Charles Bell came on his blitz. It got picked up, but it was the coverage by the Delaware defense there initially, forced Goldrich to double clutch, and then the pressure eventually landed.
Christian Bretta on fourth down and 6 from the Delaware 46 will punt it away. He stands at his own 45. And he'll go over the head of Deontay Terry, caught at the 2-yard line. Great coverage that time by Dougie Moss, who got back in special teams coverage. A 44-yard punt will start Delaware's drive at their own 2 with 5:04 left in the second quarter, down by 1. New Hampshire 7, Delaware 6. Both teams scored on their opening drive, and we've had no points ever since.
Yeah, good job by New Hampshire on special teams to bounce back and set up a long field. Field position has been tilted against the Hens for a while now.
Let's get a Glasgow Medical Aid Unit scoreboard update. A couple games already underway in the CAA.
Of course, the big one is down there in Harrisonburg. Not on ESPN. Just game day was on ESPN. We should point that out. But JMU right now after a quarter leading Richmond 14-7. So Lee Corso looking wise so far. Meanwhile, final from earlier today, Maine over Stony Brook 23-10.
Hens will start in the I form. Yoakum is the fullback. Jefferson the running back. They'll give it to Jefferson. Stutter step, and now he pushes his way forward to the 5, giving Delaware some space to operate on second down and 7.
Boy, he is phenomenal the way he can kind of go from 0 to 60 in no time flat. That stutter step that you alluded, and then still has the ability to get velocity going and finish that run and nudge his way forward for an extra yard or so. That's a skill not a lot of backs have. The ability to cut back against the grain, we've seen more and more of that in football, but the ability to cut it back against the grain and make a guy miss or cut back against the grain and run through somebody. Jefferson possesses both, and now Delaware can't get their packages right and has to burn a timeout. We've seen way too much of that here lately.
4:24 left in the second quarter, and Delaware calls their first timeout. We'll stay right here. I want to remind our listeners that a portion of this broadcast brought to you by Dash In. With Veterans Day coming up on November 11th, Dash In will be awarding one veteran or member of the military with free coffee and gas for a year. Send in a letter about a veteran or military member in your life, and you could win them free coffee and gas for an entire year. Send your entries to dashinsweepstakes.com.
By the way, real quick, finishing up that scoreboard, Scotty, that we were doing earlier, there was one other game that's in action right now. Late first quarter, William & Mary going outside the conference. They lead Hampton 6-0. And then one other game that'll get started about 7 o'clock. Coming into the season, you thought that would be a big one. Villanova at Towson. Both teams have disappointed, especially the Wildcats losing John Robertson for the season. Not much on the line, although both teams really staring at a postseason disqualification. They have 3 losses entering that contest. Only one will leave still a contender.
The rest of the CAA can write us thank you notes for taking care of John Robertson early in the year. 2nd and 7 after the timeout for Delaware. Walker standing in shotgun form, feet at the goal line. They're going to give it to Thomas Jefferson, powering and pushing his way for first down yardage out to the 16. Thomas Jefferson is something else to watch. You just described the way he ran a couple of plays ago, and he just does it time and time again.
I look clairvoyant there because he breaks a tackle, he runs through an arm tackle, and then a stiff arm and just accelerates for 5 extra yards. He's bottled up at the 11, is able to run through an arm tackle, then stiff arms a linebacker, and then just speeds his way for the first down. That is a run completely created by the running back. There was nothing there whatsoever. Impressive stuff again from TJ.
McNally brought him down 1st and 10. Lots of movement before the snap. It was Jake Trump.
5-yard penalty, first down.
Can't have those types of mistakes if you're Delaware. Another unforced error. 2nd pre-snap penalty the Hens have committed now on their last 2 possessions. They put them behind the sticks last time and forced a punt deep in their own territory. Defense stepped up and had the offenses back. But now you risk something similar here as this first half winds down. You have to be a little bit more crisp with your execution when you're going to play the style of football that Delaware is attempting this season.
New Hampshire up 7-6, 3:26 and ticking. 2nd quarter action, shotgun form for Walker on 1st and 15. Walker going to tuck, keeping himself, tries to get to the outside, but cannot. Tackle made by Akeel Anderson, one of the defensive captains at the 11-yard line.
Linebacker playing downhill. Good job by Anderson to stick with his assignment. He has to stay on that weak side of the formation. The fake was the sweep running right, Jefferson, and then a designed quarterback run to the left. But Anderson not at all fooled by the fake. Goes downhill, and really nobody accounting there for Anderson. He's got to take a false step on the play action for that play to work.
2nd down and 15 coming up. Walker taking his time, going back to the huddle, getting the signal from the sideline. Play clock down to 5. Walker going to have to hurry. Play clock's at 2. At 1. And he gets it off with the give to Thomas Jefferson. Starts up the gut. Tries to push his way to the 15-yard line and does so. Nice tackling by New Hampshire, and a timeout's going to be taken by the Wildcats as they've got Delaware in a 3rd-and-11 situation. They're thinking about perhaps getting the ball back.
Yeah, I have no problem with Delaware winding the clock down there. I think that was done by design. You know you're on your own side of the field, back at the 15. You're at a 3rd down and long. I think that the Hens will probably keep this one on the ground, force UNH to burn another one of their timeouts. Also try to get any yardage that you can here to help your putter, Eric Anderson, who's obviously been one of the best in the country. And you hate to say that on 3rd down and 11. It's just not been a high percentage play for the Hens this season. With the way New Hampshire rushes the passer, so effective in sack yardage this season, I just don't think you want to risk giving up any more field position here. If you're UD, you want to try to mitigate your losses, play the field position game, and see if you can get into the locker room down by only a point.
Delaware this season, 39% on 3rd down, a 3rd down coming up. But you're absolutely right, Matt. This New Hampshire Wildcats team has been tough with all of the pressure they've been able to put on quarterbacks. 20 sacks, we mentioned that in the pregame show. Keep the ball on the ground and let Anderson boom one and play the field position game with 2:30 left. 2:31 to be exact. Second quarter, Delaware back on the field, 3rd-and-11 from their own 15-yard line. Walker in shotgun form with Jefferson to his left. Walker going to keep it himself, running wide, cuts it at the 15, darts up the field to the 20. First down yardage picked up across the 30, but a flag is thrown back at the 10, and it could be coming back against Delaware.
Yeah, it's a hold on the Hens.
81 offense, half the distance from the original line of scrimmage, 3rd down.
That's the second penalty on Brandon Whaley in today's game.
In Whaley's defense, there was immediate penetration. Walker went wide and then stopped. And Whaley was in position to make a block. And then once Walker kind of cut back, that forced the hold, and he grabbed. I mean, it's a good call. It's an obvious call. The good news for Delaware, it forces New Hampshire to call a timeout because the penalty happens outside of 2 minutes of the first half. The clock would have restarted. So as a result, New Hampshire has to take its second timeout here. They're down to 1. And now you can run the football again, force them to use their last timeout. New Hampshire will still have plenty of time, but at least it makes it a little tougher on the Wildcats. By the way, one other thing is I take a look at our stats here. I'm not sure whether it's 2015 or 1982. I just don't know what we're watching in this day and age of football to watch almost an entire half of a game and to see the two quarterbacks combine to throw for 72 yards is jarring to the system, isn't it? I mean, this is just not the sport we've grown accustomed to seeing here over the last several years.
Especially when you think about the last regular season game at Delaware Stadium between these two teams when there was almost 1,000 yards of offense and Joe Flacco and Ricky Santos, the defenses might as well have not showed up. It was target practice that day.
Well, you know, the fans you hear all the time longing for back in the days of Tubby Raven and the wing T. Well, these are wing T type statistics. I'll say that much. Maybe not quite as much on the ground as you'd like, but this is incredible to see this little production through the air.
3rd down and 18 for Delaware. Ball on their own 8-yard line. They'll keep it on the ground. Thomas Jefferson has a lead blocker down at the 20-yard line. So they get a good chunk of it down actually to the 21. And the stop made by Dougie Moss. So it'll be 4th down for Delaware. 2:13 remaining. New Hampshire will call another timeout. And Eric Anderson will have a chance to boot it away when the Hens special team unit gets back on the field.
But very positive there to make the best of a bad situation. You got 13 yards, which are big field position yards. You force New Hampshire to burn all three of their timeouts. And now if Anderson can get off a good kick, you'll be in very good position on the field. You should be able to make New Hampshire start this drive somewhere around their own 40-yard line with Anderson's average, you know, net punt. That's a win considering where you were going into that 3rd down and long. So the execution on that 3rd down run going downhill the way Delaware did, it's not pretty. It's not necessarily the type of the football that you'd hope to be watching. And eventually, long term, Delaware needs to get into a position where they can pick up a 3rd and 15 and 16. But in this game where Delaware is at this stage of the building process, that's good football from the Hens. Your goal, once you shot yourself in the foot with that 5-yard penalty and went backwards, was to try to make sure you're down by a point at the locker room.
Anderson will come out after the timeout. Last timeout taken by New Hampshire. They'll have none remaining with 2:15 left on the first half clock. And a 7-6 lead for the Wildcats. Anderson back to punt. Gets it in his hands. Gets it away. It's high. It's long. It's sending Casey DeAndre back. He waves and catches it at the 33-yard line. Fair catch was made there. 46-yard punt by Eric Anderson. So New Hampshire, an offense that's had just 81 total yards on the day, will get the football with 2:07 and no timeouts. And you remember, New Hampshire up 7-6, but that first drive of the game is when they scored, and that's when they started on the Delaware 46 after the onside kick fail.
And statistically, Delaware has had the better half. I mean, we talk about it not being pretty. It hasn't been pretty for either side, unless you like defense. Defenses have both played really well, and because both teams are run-first clubs, it has shortened the game. The number of possessions, low. But if you're the Hens, you're still down because of that gamble that didn't work out. You need to make sure you keep New Hampshire off the board here. You don't want to let Goldridge get going on this last drive of the half.
Trips to the right side to start things off for Goldrich and the UNH offense. First and 10 from their own 33. Kyan Taylor split to the left. Throwing towards Taylor. He bobbles it and drops it at the 50. Kyan Taylor, maybe a little rust. He was suspended for the first six games of the season. This is the first game playing after a violation of team rules, and he couldn't haul that one through.
You can't drop that football, especially if you're a guy who hurt your team by doing something silly. And then you come out, you're on a good route there. Delaware want to make sure nobody gets behind him in this situation. Taylor broke that route, came back to his quarterback. Goldridge delivered a strike. Just a good throw there from the experienced quarterback. Hit him right in the chest. The ball bounced right off his shoulder pad.
Goldridge 7 of 10 after that incomplete pass. Second and 10 from New Hampshire 33. In motion goes Allison. Goldridge wants to throw again. He will. Slings it down the field. Batted away. And a penalty flag is going to be thrown, as Mark Doe was holding on to the wide receiver.
That's back shoulder throw, purposely underthrown.
12, defense, 15 yards from the original line of scrimmage, first down.
And there's some hand fighting there, and you can see where Delaware is a little frustrated, but from up here, it looked like there was a little extension of jersey, and Goldridge tried to adjust to the football. As much as defensive players don't want to hear it, Michael Atenraze is in our ear. He's not happy about it, but they're going to give the benefit of the doubt to the offensive player in that situation, and Doe grabbed just enough of the jersey extension that the official's going to throw the flag on that 9 times out of 10.
And he did that time. Under 2 minutes, it advances the football up to the 48-yard line in New Hampshire territory. 15-yard penalty. Goldridge back in the gun. Jackson blitzing from the right side. Goldridge pumps once, throws low, and incomplete to Jordan Powell. Powell, the tight end, had 5 catches a week ago, yet to haul one in today.
5 catches each of his last 2 games, and has been their most consistent receiver all season long. We talked about their starting wide receivers last week combined for 2 catches, which is hard to believe in this offense. Great defense to help Delaware there by the umpire. Really, I think, got in Powell's view and line of sight and did not allow him to dive for that ball.
Trips to the right side on 2nd and 10. New Hampshire with a 7-6 lead, 1:53 to go in the second quarter. Goldridge throws it behind his intended receiver, Amici Walker, and it's Nasir Adderley with the pass breakup that time.
I think, to be honest, it was more Walker that broke up that pass from being intercepted to a Nasir Adderley. That, as good as Goldridge has been in terms of accuracy on this drive, that one was erratic out of nowhere, well behind his intended target. Very good knockdown by his receiver to save a pick.
Two wide receivers to both sides of the field for Goldrich on 3rd and 10 from his own 48. Here's Goldrich. Tinsley with some pressure. Goldrich throwing far side of the field. Caught by Crossan. Bell drags him out shy of the first down marker, but it'll be 4th and 1 for New Hampshire.
And they will go for it. I mean, I just not a doubt in my mind that New Hampshire will keep the offense on the field. Good job by Goldrich. Looked the defense off to the left, got the flow going that direction, knew where his check down was, and then slung one out. That's Bell one-on-one. Phenomenal tackle to drag a very dangerous guy in Dalton Crossan to the sideline, shy of first down. What a stop by the sophomore linebacker.
4th and 1 for New Hampshire. Ball in the Delaware 43-yard line. Wildcats 2 of 2 today on third down. Crossan is the back. Goldrich in shotgun form. Crossan gets it. First down and more. Stiff arm out to the Delaware 30, and Ray Jones tackled him from behind. But the third fourth down pickup of the day will extend the drive for UNH.
Well designed by Ryan Carney, the New Hampshire offensive coordinator. Delaware keyed up, flooded the right side, and they came back with a counter to the opposite side of the formation.
Now a whistle on the field.
The Hens might call a timeout here, where the clock did not stop. Not sure what it was, actually. The side judge came for the Delaware sideline.
We're waiting for what I thought was going to be some clarification, but we get none here.
Brock was out on the field. I guess they didn't start the clock after picking up the first down. That's what it was.
Now first and 10 for New Hampshire. 1:19. Goldrich throwing. Caught by Powell. Stopped in his tracks by who else? Nasir Adderley at the 25.
High percentage throw. Good read from Goldrich. Adderley just a step late to get there in time to break it up, but he made a good stop that keeps the clock running.
Remember, UNH, no timeouts remaining. 60 seconds left and a one-point lead for the Wildcats. Second and 6. From the Delaware 24, over the middle, incomplete. Nasir Adderley again broke it up at the 15-yard line. Would have been good for a first down, but the freshman makes the stop.
And Adderley's presence allows Delaware to be so much more dynamic with their calls. That time they brought a blitz. Six-man rushing, including Charles Bell coming in. Bell was going to get there, so Goldrich had to pull the trigger before he wanted to. And Adderley just draped all over his man. Great coverage from the freshman. This kid is incredible. Just out of high school to be able to do this against every team they play.
Only 18 years old is Nasir Adderley, a true freshman. Third down and 6. Here comes New Hampshire, lobbing it for the end zone. Batted and nearly intercepted. It was Nasir Adderley again with the pass breakup back to back. Great plays by the 18-year-old.
Good job by Adderley. He was beat that time initially by Aaron Lewis, Sinalis on the outside, I think it was. And as a result, you see a lot of guys just kind of grab on for dear life. But Adderley trusted his speed, thought he could recover. And it was an underthrown football by Goldrich. And because there was no contact for Adderley, he's face guarded and was able to get his hand on the ball to deflect it away.
Not a strong kicking team for New Hampshire, so they're going to stay on the field on fourth down and 6. 49 seconds left in the first half and a one-point lead from the Delaware 24. Goldrich, pressure coming. Same play, and this time a different result as they lob it to Kion Taylor, shy of the end zone, but a diving one-handed grab gets New Hampshire down to the 2-yard line.
What a catch. How did he get his hand on that football? As Delaware is going to take a timeout here to try to regroup and see if they can rise up and get a stop. How did he catch that football? How do you drop the one he did earlier that hit him square in the chest? That ball overthrown by Goldrich as they ran a little wheel or a little go route on the outside. Delaware brought the blitz. Goldrich gave his receiver an opportunity to run underneath of it. Taylor could not quite get to the football, so he lays out and parallel to the ground as his shoulder is about to drill into the turf, grabs it with one hand, and then almost instantaneously scooped it back to his body. If he doesn't get that ball into his body, when he rolls over, it's going to pop out incomplete. It's one thing to grab it one-handed. It's another thing to get it into his body as quickly as he did. Torres was a little late coming over from his safety position. Again, Goldrich using his eyes, Scotty. Just a little look to the left, forced a false step from Torres and left Justin Watson and Nasir Adderley on an island. And there's only so long you can ask your corners to stay out there one-on-one so many times before eventually the quarterback's going to be able to connect with his target.
It was a 22-yard pickup on fourth down. New Hampshire now 4-0-4 on fourth down conversions. Trips to the left side. Ball on the far side hash, first and goal to go from the 2. Crossan is the running back. The give is to Dalton Crossan and wrapped up at the line of scrimmage. Great defense by Delaware. Charles Bell finished the play, but Vince Hollerman and Josh Plummer got it started.
Remember, no timeouts here for New Hampshire, so they're in full scramble mode. They just substituted, so the umpire's got to come in and hold this play up here.
And he's doing just that. 18 seconds now for New Hampshire. Goldrich in shotgun form, still at the 2-yard line. Looking left, back corner end zone, incomplete. The target was Rory Donovan. It'll be third and goal to go with 10 seconds left and no timeouts for New Hampshire.
And if you're the Hens here, you know that the percentages say this is a throw here from New Hampshire. How much guts does Sean McDonald and Ryan Carty have? Because if you run and you don't get it, that's it. Half is over. And certainly it's a New Hampshire team that's willing to gamble, but you'd have to think this is a pass so they can kick the field goal on fourth down.
Goldrich in shotgun form. Crossan is his running back. Three wide receivers on the field. Goldrich bobbles the snap, gets it back, throws for Allison in the end zone. It's caught. No signal yet as he bobbled it. Now we see the hands go up. A touchdown for New Hampshire with 5 seconds remaining in the second quarter. Wildcats up 13-6.
Wow, really well-designed play. They ran a little pick on the outside. Slot receiver comes towards the center of the field, gets a rub on, I think it was Justin Watson that time, allowed the free of release to the outside, and then just a perfectly thrown football by Sean Goldridge to the back pylon. Great execution from UNH.
UNH will bookend the first half with touchdown drives. Christian Bretta will try the PAT. That one's through. And New Hampshire leads 14-6. That's your PNC Bank timeout score with 5 seconds left in quarter number two. Back in a moment.
The area's largest family-owned and operated pet supply store is proud to support University of Delaware Blue Hen football. Concord Pet Foods and Supply.
New Hampshire got the football with 2:07 left. And now with 5 seconds remaining in the first half, they'll kick off to Delaware after a 12-play, 67-yard drive that gives them a 14-6 lead. And unless something miraculous happens here, they'll take that into the locker room. Squib kick, and it'll be Ray Jones waiting for it at the 12-yard line, near side of the field, now at the 20, to the 30-yard line, into some traffic there. And down he goes at the 32. That's the final play of the first half. So a 67-yard drive to end quarter number two puts New Hampshire up 14-6. We're going to hear from head coach Dave Brock in just a moment. Michael Attanase will have him as he heads to the locker room. Don't go anywhere. At the half, we've got our Blue Hens halftime report presented by International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, Local 313, and its local contractors. Benny Pinella will be in the studio with your scoreboard update and your Blue Hens sports report. But New Hampshire will take a 14-6 lead into the locker room. And Michael Attanase awaiting Coach Brock in the end zone. And now Coach Brock with Michael will send it down to Mike on the sideline.
Hey, Coach, I have to ask, what did you see in the UNH return that prompted that onside kick to start the game?
Well, we felt like we had numbers, and we tried to jumpstart the game, and the kid made a good play. You know, that was something we decided to do early in the week and thought we would be able to get it, and we didn't execute it, and we didn't get it. So, you know, again, kids are playing really hard. We got to play better offensively and keep battling defensively. We got picked down there at the end and gave up a tough one. When we get the ball to start the half, we got to play better than them in the second half.
All right, Coach, you mentioned it, but the first drive was amazing. We moved the ball in the air, on the ground, and then we seemed to sputter since then. What are other adjustments going into the second half?
Well, we can't have pre-snap penalties. We had a couple of those. We had two holds. You know, so, I mean, we got to clean up some of the mistakes we're making, and we just got to keep playing hard, and good things will happen. I mean, keep battling like crazy on defense.
All right, thank you, Coach. Good luck in the second. Guys.
All right, thank you, Mike.
Anna Voistock, Gertie Wilson, Eric Wiscount, Patrick Wise, and Angela Yu. Congratulations and thanks to all of you for your contributions to the university community. In addition, the University of Delaware Alumni Association is pleased to acknowledge one of these ambassadors as a recipient of the T. Monty Keith Spirit Award. This $1,000 scholarship is given annually to one student alumni ambassador in recognition of their outstanding spirit and leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a unique honor. Today we recognize Julia Perez as the 2015 University of Delaware Alumni Association T. Monty Keith Spirit Award recipient. Julia is a junior from Park Ridge, New Jersey, and is working towards a major in health sciences. She has served on the University of Delaware Student Alumni Ambassador for 3 years and has taken on many leadership roles. Julia is currently serving on the executive board as Vice President of Outreach. Congratulations, Julia Perez. And let's have a great big Blue Hens round of applause for all of our University of Delaware student alumni ambassadors. Ladies and gentlemen, performing the second half of their show, Phantom of the Opera. Please welcome the pride of Delaware, the University of Delaware Fighting Blue Hens Marching Band.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this year marks the 75th anniversary of the University of Delaware Marching Band. Today we welcome both past and present directors representing the entire history of the program. J. Robert King was hired in 1945 and charged with creating the first official marching band under the auspices of the Department of Music. He served as the marching band director from 1946 to 1972. Bob King passed away in 1984 and is represented today by his daughter. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Helen King Spence. Hired by Bob King as an assistant director in 1965, David Blackington became the marching band director in 1973. He served in that capacity until 1979, when he left University of Delaware to become the director of bands at Brigham Young University. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome David Blackington. Assistant director from 1975 to 1979, Robert J. Streckless took up the reins after David Blackington departed and served as director from 1980 to 1989. Bob remained as University of Delaware Wind Ensemble Coordinator, teacher of music education courses until his retirement as Professor Emeritus in 2011. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Robert J. Streckless. Unable to be with us today, Alan Hammond first began as the marching band's assistant director and trumpet professor. He took over as director when Bob Streckless stepped down and held the post until 1994. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for Alan Hammond. In 1995, brought two new faces to Delaware. Both individuals got their starts in the marching band world as part of the University of Massachusetts Minuteman Marching Band. Both have rich histories with numerous drum and bugle corps. Both are recognized nationally and internationally for their extensive contributions to marching arts. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome current assistant director James P. Ancona and director Heidi I. Syver. Congratulations to the University of Delaware and Fighting Blue Hens Marching Band on its 75th anniversary!
WDSD.
Welcome back. Delaware Stadium at the half. It's New Hampshire 14 and the Hens 6. I'm Matt Janis, Scott Klatskin, James Taylor here as well. Michael Diodati and Michael Atadraze on the field. Tough first half for Delaware as New Hampshire able to bookend the opening 30 minutes with scores. Let's take a look and see how it unfolded. It was immediate adversity as Delaware thought they saw something on the film. Dave Brock saying to Michael Atadraze into the break that They thought they had an opportunity, so they decided to try a surprise onside to begin the game. They shifted to the left side of the formation. They tried an onside kick to the left side. Unfortunately, it went right into the chest of a New Hampshire player, and the Wildcats were in business at the Delaware 44. A fourth and one conversion on the ground, then a fourth and three conversion in through the air from inside the 10, put New Hampshire at the Delaware 5, where the Wildcats got on the board first. It was a touchdown pass from Sean Goldridge that gave a 7-0 lead to New Hampshire. But to the credit of this Delaware team, they were able to respond. A balanced drive, as a matter of fact, in response for the Hens. 34 yards on the ground, 21 through the air, plus a 15-yard pass interference penalty. Thomas Jefferson had 32 of the yards on the ground on the drive, plus he had two catches, and he finished the march off with a 2-yard touchdown run that shouldn't have tied the game. But then Frank Rago came in, short-footed guy, and missed the extra point. He pulled it to the left, and so the lead was won at 7-6. On the ensuing drive, New Hampshire was able to move the football into Delaware territory, but the Hens blitz. Charles Bell came driving up the middle. Sean Goldridge threw it before he was ready. And Simba Guashavano made an incredible athletic play, breaking on the football. And a diving pick gave Delaware the football in reasonable field position. That was near the end of the opening quarter. The Hens were able to get the ball into New Hampshire territory, but the drive stalled, a fourth down and 7. Instead of going for it from the 27-yard line, Daybrock elected to try a long field goal. Rago came out for a 45-yarder. It was short by a couple of yards, and as a result, Delaware stayed down by a point. The rest of the second quarter, unfortunately for the Hens, was played on their side of the field. Delaware had bad field position and couldn't do much offensively. As a matter of fact, they're still at 20 yards passing where they were after the first drive, and eventually New Hampshire was able to take advantage of a short field. After punting, the Wildcats got the football back with just over 2 minutes to go at their own 33 with no timeouts remaining. They marched down the field 57 yards. The big play coming on a fourth down and 7 pass that got them inside the 5. And on third and goal with 10 seconds left, Sean Goldridge threw a touchdown to the back pylon that padded the New Hampshire lead to 14-6. So as a result, the Hens down by 8. Delaware will get the football to start the second half, but the momentum that they had gained back after that very difficult start to the game has dissipated and now belongs firmly in the corner of New Hampshire.
Yeah, a way to get that momentum back is if you can have a similar first drive that you had to open up the game on offense. As Delaware, as Coach Brock pointed out, will get the ball first to start this second half of action. Let's get you the stats from the first half, brought to you by RE/MAX. Nobody sells real estate than RE/MAX. Outstanding agents, outstanding results. Delaware down 14-6 at the break. 8 first downs for Delaware, 7 for New Hampshire. And even 100 yards rushing for the Hens, just 40 for New Hampshire. But New Hampshire, 93 yards through the air, 20 for Delaware. Total offense, New Hampshire, 35 plays, 133 yards. Delaware, 26 plays for 122. Time of possession, New Hampshire, 14-40. Delaware, 15-20 in that first half. New Hampshire, just 2 of 9. And third down conversions, but they haven't needed to convert on third down because they've converted on fourth down. 4 of 4 on the game. Both scoring drives for New Hampshire, they were 2 of 2 converting on fourth down. You heard Matt describe a 22-yard pickup to Kion Taylor on fourth down that dropped them to the 2-yard line and eventually led to the final score of the half for New Hampshire. Delaware, 3 of 6 on third down. They have not tried on fourth down. They did try a field goal on a fourth down with Frank Rago missing from 45 yards away. Each team has scored each time they've been in the red zone. 2 of 2, New Hampshire. Delaware, 1 of 1. Individually for Delaware, Thomas Jefferson on his way to another 100-yard day. He's got 55 on 9 carries and a score, a 15-yard long on the day. Joe Walker with 23 yards rushing, 15-yard long for him. Kareem Williams, 6 carries, 22 yards for UNH. Dalton Crossan leads the way, 7 carries, 28 yards, and a touchdown. Passing, Sean Goldridge is 11 of 19, does have an interception, 89 yards passing, and a touchdown pass, as Matt described. Joe Walker, just 6 attempts, 20 yards. He's 4 of 6. He has been sacked once. Deontay Cherry, 2 catches for 8 yards, leads the receivers. Thomas Jefferson has 1 for 13. Jared Allison for New Hampshire leads the receivers, 4 for 16 yards. Amici Walker has 3 catches. Jordan Powell, the tight end, with 2, and Kion Taylor, we mentioned that, 1 for 22 yards. Defensively, Casey DeAndre has 7 tackles. Cam Shuri with five and a sack. 1.5 tackles for loss. Hayden Knudsen with 5 tackles and a tackle for loss. Kevin McNally with 3 to lead New Hampshire. For Delaware on defense, Charles Bell has 6. Nasir Adderley, so active in this contest. He has 5 tackles, 3 for David Tinsley, including a sack, his 4th on the season. And Ray Jones with 2.
Tell you what, Scott, you know, maybe this is just the immature portion of my personality, or maybe I'm a more petty person than I thought I was, but the one silver lining at the half, I don't know if you saw the score that just flashed up on the screen, but perhaps they got a little too happy too soon at JMU today. The Dukes are down in the third quarter to Richmond, 25-21. Certainly it'll be of little consolation if the Hens can't win this game today, but it would be nice to see JMU's big day, the rain come down on their parade a little bit, wouldn't it?
I think we're all Richmond Spider fans here at Delaware Stadium. All Blue Hens fans, of course, good crowd on hand today to watch Delaware on Parents and Family Weekend. It's the 33rd meeting between these two teams all time. Delaware leads 20-12, but UNH has won 5 of the last 6. New Hampshire got in the top 25 in 2004 after winning a game in this stadium. They've been in the top 25 ever since, 162 consecutive weeks, but they are out for the first time this week, and because of that, every game a playoff game for New Hampshire, trying to extend an 11-year playoff streak, and it'll be up to this game and next week after that for New Hampshire to keep on winning if they want to get in. So every game very important for the Wildcats, and right now a 14-6 lead.
Amazing the bookends of that streak, too. They entered the poll at 19. They exited the poll at 19. They entered the poll off a win against Delaware, and they exited it going into a game against Delaware. Almost creepy.
Delaware will get the football first, going right to left, backs to the student section, down 14-6. And Ray Jones is the deep man for Delaware. He'll have a shot at it. His 21-yard return ended the first half. He'll catch it at the 14 to the 20-yard line, gets a block to the 30-yard line. Now 35 contact there, and that's where he goes down. Tackle was made on special teams by Patrick Mensah, the defensive back of New Hampshire. Delaware offense coming back out, 100 yards rushing on the day, 55 of them by Thomas Jefferson. He's the starting running back. Just a recap of starters brought to you by National 5 and 10. Walker is the QB. Deontay Cherry back, and he has 2 catches at the wide receiver position. Owen Tyler and Kyle Yoakum and Brandon Whaley going to start this second half. So 3 tight ends, and it'll be Yoakum in the offset I form, joining Kareem Williams, in fact, in the backfield. 1st and 10 from the 35 for Delaware, and they'll give it to Williams, running to the left side and pushing through traffic out to the 37. A 2-yard pickup on 1st down to start the second half.
It's a very important drive, you really feel like, because New Hampshire having that momentum going into the locker room. Maybe their offense found something there after Delaware played so well over the first 27, 28 minutes of that first half. This is a Delaware team that I know they came back from a 9-point deficit in the fourth quarter once this year against William & Mary, but obviously not built to come from behind. A 2-score deficit might be too much to overcome. You need something positive out of this possession, you feel like.
Papali and Cherries on the right side on 2nd down and 7 for Walker in shotgun form. QB read, and they'll give it to Williams. He lowers his head, gets hit by the linebacking core at the 41-yard line, and it was Hayden Knudsen again in on the stop. Daniel Rowe cleaned it up.
And Angeline lined up as an H-back. Good block at the point of impact. There's just too many bodies up near the line of scrimmage. I mean, you blocked it up, hat on a hat, but there's another linebacker to fill and then a safety coming up to help in support. And you're in 3rd down and 4. Now, 3rd and 4 is a manageable situation, but you haven't been great on 3rd downs and more than 1 or 2 all season long because you haven't been much of a passing attack.
Williams is back on 3rd down and 4 for Delaware. First possession of the second half as Cherry goes in motion. Bunch trips to the right side. Walker rolling that way. Pumping, now hit in the backfield and goes down. He's lost the football, but he was down after the sack by Julian Turner. 9th tackle for loss on the year by the captain, Turner, and Delaware will have to punt after a 3-and-out.
Well, they wanted to get that ball in the flat to Deontay Cherry. He was taken away. Good coverage by New Hampshire. Walker's 2nd read was a decision to tuck and try to run across the grain, but give Turner credit. He just kept charging. He was the right end, came all the way to the opposite side of the field and just decked Walker in the backfield.
Big defensive lineman of this New Hampshire team. Another sack, 21st sack of the year for New Hampshire. And now we'll see Eric Anderson again. Light pressure coming, gets this one away.
DeAndre back to return. He'll grab it from the 18-yard line. Eludes one tackler and hit hard. Popped! Anthony Jackson with the special team stop at the 22-yard line after a 47-yard punt and a 5-yard return. Jackson, the starting linebacker, getting it done on special teams.
Needing some sort of a lift. Perhaps that big hat hit can provide it. Anthony Jackson, who's pretty sure tackler. Charles Bell, of course, in that same class at the linebacker position, has been near the top of the list in terms of tacklers this season for Delaware. Getting a lot of production out of that sophomore class. And maybe Jackson, with that big blow, gets the game turned around.
Trips to the left side, New Hampshire's first possession of the second half. Dalton Crossan trying to get past the Delaware defender, but get out. It was Hollerman who slowed him up, and then a swarm of blue jerseys brought him down for a big loss at the 18, a loss of 5 on first down.
That's Andrew Lauderdale, one of the best offensive linemen in this conference. Now, he's not 100%. He missed the last couple of weeks with injury, but he just got blown past by Hollerman, who got into the backfield. And they did a good job to stick with Crossan, too, by the way. He's a tough guy to bring down. That's good play all around.
Trips again to the left side of the field on second and 15. This time from the UNH 18-yard line. Allison goes in motion from left to right. Here's Goldrich dropping back, throwing over the middle of the field. Adderley again! Nasir Adderley all day breaking up passes.
Well, you'll take that matchup if you're Delaware. If you can get Nasir Adderley on a tight end, that's pretty good odds that you're going to be able to get the stop. Now, give UNH some credit. Essentially, what they tried to do was get Jordan Powell over the middle, use his big frame to almost play basketball there with Adderley, box him out to get position. So Adderley figured it out. He went up high and came swiping through to knock the ball down.
Now, third down and 15 for New Hampshire from their own 18-yard line. Goldrich looking. Throw it. It's high and far for Allison. Incomplete. Watson in coverage. And we'll see the punt unit now for New Hampshire. Three and outs both ways to start the second half.
Great coverage from Justin Watson. You got a chance to talk to him this week at the coach's show. And then, of course, you got a chance to meet his parents at the pregame show. They were around both sport number 22 jerseys before the game and have a lot of pride in their son, and for good reason. Good kid, good player. Great coverage there. Forced a perfect throw from Goldrich, and he couldn't make it.
Chance for Delaware to get some good field position after a punt coming up from Christian Bretta. Deontay Cherry's back to return. This one coming from the New Hampshire 18-yard line. Delaware nearly gets a block. Jackson was close. A good punt by Christian Bretta. And a fair catch is made by Deontay Cherry back at the 35-yard line. That's a 47-yard kick by Christian Bretta. Let's set it down to the sideline. And Michael Attanasio.
Guys, we are witnessing a great effort by Delaware's defense. When you're talking about offense, defense, it's almost like a conversation. Delaware's defense is talking a whole lot right now. We need the offense to talk back. We need the offense to respond to make this game whole again.
Yeah, right now it's kind of a one-sided conversation, to be blatantly honest. So you're right about it, Mike. The defense, considering the short fields they've had to deal with, considering how much time they have spent on the field after the initial burst from UNH, all things considered, you're happy with that side of the football. The offense has to start to carry its weight.
Delaware will start this drive on their own 35. In motion goes Williams. Rolling out is Walker. Looking for Jefferson. Not there. Throwing it hard. And Riley Angeline at the 49-yard line. Held on to the football. Nice catch by Riley Angeline at the 49. A first down pickup for Delaware.
Two things Joe Walker did really well there. Good play action fake, I thought, froze the defense, and then a good decision that time. He had three wide receivers on that side of the field, and he went to the most vertical shot there in Angeline, threw it low away from the hit, but gave his receiver a chance to go down and dig it out.
Angeline, three catches over 90 yards on the season now. First and 10 as Angeline goes in motion. The H-back ball in the Delaware 49. Play action. Walker lobbing middle of the field. Looking for Angeline. Just high for Angeline. Looked like Hayden Knudsen was holding on to Angeline, but no call.
Get rid of looked like from that sentence. That is ridiculous that play is not called. That was a perfect play call from Sean Devine, and just a great route run straight up the center of the field from Angeline. It was actually a pretty good throw from Walker as well. And how in the world they don't get Knudsen for a hold? He grabbed early and he grabbed late. He grabbed two different times. Horrific piece of officiating that time, and a game-changing no call.
Now back split with Cherry and Jefferson. Cherry will retreat to the wide receiver position. And the give is to Jefferson, the running back, who gets to the 50-yard line. 1 yard pickup on second and 10 as Cam Shorey, the big junior from Maine, makes another step.
Well, a little surprised that Delaware did not have some type of a look over to the sideline to change that play. They had 2-on-1 on the outside. Deontay Cherry lined up as that back receiver. If you snap that football and just toss it over to Cherry, the safety was 10 yards back on that side of the field, cheating towards the center, trying to come up in run production. That would have been an easy 5 or 6 yard gain.
Instead, it's third down and 9 from midfield for Delaware. Down 14-6. Screen pass is caught by Jefferson. Gets the block he needs to the 40, 35. Cuts it back at the 30. Flag is down as Jefferson gets inside the 25. But I'm afraid this one might be coming back.
Another bad call, though. I think they're going to get a block and a back on Will Lewis. And I thought he got there in position. I thought it was a clean block. Unless they're going to say that it was illegal man downfield and the ball was caught beyond the line of scrimmage, which might be a different conversation. But if they're saying an illegal block, I thought Lewis
There's
got
no
there.
There's no ball on the play for a block in the back. Defender turned on the player. Result of the play, first down.
There were two close plays there where if the ball is beyond the line of scrimmage, the lineman can't be down the field. It was not. It was 2 yards behind the line of scrimmage looking on replay. Then in terms of the block, I thought Lewis got his shoulder as it was, but the defender couldn't see who it was who flashed in front of Lewis, kind of turned his shoulder to avoid the brunt of the contact, and that gives Lewis no chance whatsoever. Good piece of officiating to come in and correct it. They certainly owed Delaware one.
Making up for the holding play. Offset eye as Walker goes under center with Yoakum as the H-back. Ball on the New Hampshire 22. Here's Jefferson looking for a hole, can't find one. Back to line of scrimmage, maybe a yard by Thomas Jefferson as Casey DeAndre came up to make his eighth tackle of the day.
I mean, they are just kamikazing their way to the line of scrimmage. That time, it was the linebacker McNally that blew up the A-gap. A great job by Jefferson to stop on a dime to just get back to the line of scrimmage. More importantly, you got an injured Brody Kern down on the field. And there's a lot of guys on this club you can't afford to lose. Kern is up near the top of the list for this offense.
Now, Brody Kern, one of those players that used the bye week to try to get healthy. If Kern is out, Mario Farinella is the next man up. They'll shift some guys over different positions as Farinella is the guard. Brody Kern is the center, but he is sitting upright at around the 28-yard line. We'll try to get a Newark urgent care injury update later on in this game, but right now it looks like he might be out for at least a couple of snaps.
And that's the reason why, not only because he's such a good football player, but because as the center, you know, he's responsible for all the calls up front on that offensive line, and then B, you're going to have to move bodies around to get guys into the right spot. It's not just a one guy out, one guy in straight switch. There'll be rotation. It just throws everything out of whack. The good news is Kern helped up walking off under his own power, so hopefully he is all right and it won't be a long absence.
Farinella does come into the game. Scores 14-6. New Hampshire had that lead at the break. Now 9:57 remaining in the third quarter. Second possession of the second half for Delaware. Big play a moment ago from Thomas Jefferson on the screen pass has Delaware a yard away from the red zone. Walker goes under center. Running back is Jefferson. Walker talking to his receivers, perhaps audibling at the line. They go to Jefferson, and he's tripped up at the 20-yard line. Great job by Akeel Anderson to get a hand in there and trip him up.
I don't know where Anderson came from. That was just a full extension dive. Got his forearm on about the thigh of Jefferson, and Jefferson doesn't come down on that kind of contact too often, but a yeoman's effort from Anderson because everybody else was blocked up and Jefferson had a hole, and he at least gets a first down, maybe sneaks his way into the end zone if not for the effort from Anderson.
Walker will go in shotgun form as it's third down and 7 in the red zone at the 19-yard line. Two wide receivers to the right, Jarman to the left, and it's a design keep for Walker. Has to shed one defender to get to the 15, but that's as far as she's going to get. They'll mark him down at the 16-yard line. So no first down, but in range for Frank Rago on fourth and what should be 4 to go.
I think that, well, I'm a little surprised again at the call there. If you're planning on kicking the field goal, 39 you'd think would be within Rago's range. That's what the kick would have been if he didn't pick up another yard. Actually, it probably would have been 36. You got three. got to keep your offense on the field. Very conservative that time.
This will be a 33-yard try for Frank Rago, who's 7 of 12, but has missed his last four kick attempts. This one is up from Rago, and Delaware with points on the board. Frank Rago makes it 14-9 with 8:12 remaining in the third quarter. That's your PNC Bank timeout score. We'll be back in a moment on 94.7 WDSD.
It's Delaware's first and only 24/7 urgent care center. Newark Urgent Care is proud to support you.
Delaware tradition for over 50 years. Grotto and the University of Delaware Athletics are proud to partner together to share the tradition of Delaware football with a legendary taste that is Grotto Pizza. Grotto Pizza, the official pizza of Delaware Athletics. All right, fans, it's that time again. Let's hear for your fight, Blue Heads. West stands in cockpit, yell blue. East stands in north end zone, yell heads. Ready, 1, 2, 3.
Welcome back to Delaware Stadium. I'm Scott Klatskin alongside Michael Attanase and Matt Janis. James Taylor up here with us as well. Michael Diodati with the field sound. Delaware goes 7 plays, 49 yards, and ends with 3 points on a Frank Rago 33-yard field goal. New Hampshire up 14-9, 8-12 third quarter action.
Hens run the ball there on 3rd down and 9, and a surprising decision. I know you're a line of scrimmage football team. I know that you're a run-first club, but Walker, with the exception of the Rhode Island game, has made very good decisions. I thought you'd put the ball in his hand.
McLaughlin sent it to Dalton Crossan, who takes it from the 3, near side of the field to the 15, 20, has a block at the 30, cutting at the 35, middle of the field now at the 40, dragged down from behind at the 46-yard line, and it was Ryan Torza who stopped what could have been a touchdown return by Dalton Crossan, but great field position to start this drive for New Hampshire.
And now we know why they were going sky kick early. They went onside kick, anything to try to keep the ball out of Crossan's hands in space. He had 2 very long kickoff returns last week, and hurts Delaware. As soon as the Hens get a little bit of momentum with a score, New Hampshire gets another short field position. It seems like has belonged to UNH all day long.
It'll be 1st and 10 from the New Hampshire 45-yard line with Goldrich in shotgun form. Swings it. Screen is caught by Allison to the 45 midfield. Delaware territory at the 47. Good first down pickup before Jalen Kindle came over to make the stop.
Sean McDonald called Jalen Kindle out by name this week. Said he really liked what Kindle had brought to the table in terms of his athleticism and then the ability to make tackles in space. I think you could point to a lot of different Hens, but McDonald pointed to Kindle, and Kindle didn't disappoint him there.
Maybe did disappoint him.
Yeah, you're right.
Make the nice tackle. Goldrich throws it high and incomplete on the screen pass, looking for Aaron Lewis. Sinales, the sophomore from Maryland. It'll be 3rd and short for New Hampshire.
Now let me rephrase. He did not make him look foolish. He certainly didn't want to see him make that stop. And then that time, just a poor throw from Goldrich. Any type of pressure around Goldrich, and he has been erratic with those tosses. He has made some really beautiful passes, which is part of his MO, but you just wonder if he feels completely comfortable back from that high ankle sprain, because when there has been any type of rush, he's been all over the place with his accuracy.
22 of 23 now for Goldrich on 3rd down and 2. They go to Crossan. Nothing there. Tries to bounce outside, but it's Nasir Adderley again with a big play.
Yeah, Adderley came up and made the tackle, and that's been one of his specialties. But give the credit to the defensive line. Penetration squashes it. Big number 57, Grant Roberts, and big number 95, John Nassib. Deshaun Thompson in there as well. That was very good across the board.
Yeah, my apologies. I want to give credit where credit is due. Jason Thompson, the true freshman, his first tackle of the season is a huge one. And makes it 4th down for New Hampshire with a 14-9 lead for the Wildcats. Terry back to return this punt coming from Christian Bretta. It is high and unreturnable for Terry. He'll catch it at the 8-yard line. A 43-yard kick by Christian Brett in the defense, doing a nice job once again. We'll take a timeout. Your PNC Bank timeout score before Delaware gets the football on offense. New Hampshire 14, Delaware 9, 6:45 left in the third.
All right, boys, come on.
Here at Delaware Stadium with 6:45 left in the third quarter. Delaware down 14-9, but they'll have the football at their own 9-yard line to start this drive.
A beauty pageant this has not been, but if you like physical football, then this game has been your ticket. I mean, both defenses flying around the football. That was a great job by the Delaware defensive line, Nassif and Roberts, to penetrate on that third and short and allow the D-back to come up and make the stop.
Good news for Delaware, Brody Kernan at center to start this drive. High snap, he sends the way of Walker. Jefferson breaks the tackle, second, it's Williams being chased at the 35, now 40. Down the sideline he goes at the 30. Here goes Kareem at the 20, pushed out inside the 10. Kareem Williams with a big run for Delaware. 85 yards goes Williams, it's first and goal to go.
What's the old expression, Scott? Keep pounding the rock. Delaware sticks with a run, sticks with a run, sticks with a run. Eventually it pays off. New Hampshire brought a run blitz, but they missed. There's the fix that Sean McDonald was talking about all week that he was so worried about. Poor angle, opened up a hole. Great hustle by Patrick Menza to chase him out, but what a run by Williams.
Now it's Walker under center. Jefferson is the back. Jefferson's turn. Jefferson scores. Williams sets it up. Jefferson finishes it. And Delaware takes the lead.
Wow. Blink of an eye as the Hens should go for two here to try to get the lead up to three. You want to talk about a 91.5-yard drive, and what did that take? Who said this isn't exciting? Who said this isn't a beauty pageant? Unbelievable how fast that developed. What a block on the left side. We didn't get to see the replay, and I couldn't tell who it was. Too much traffic in the way, but somebody laid out the safety, Hayden Knutson, who came up. It was Connor Bozick who just threw a great block.
Now Delaware will go for two. Muddle huddle here as Walker will be in shotgun form with Cherry in motion. He stands next to Walker. Jefferson there as well. They'll go. So Walker keeping it himself, lowers his shoulder and picks up the two-point conversion. Delaware on top, 17-14.
They ran a New Hampshire play at New Hampshire. They had a three-man line on the hash right side. They spread everybody out to the left side. They had two backs, one on each side of Walker. They faked to the back on the right who countered in front. Then they ran option to the right, and it just easy. Two on one. All Walker has to do is see where the defender goes. He came after the back, so Walker lowers his shoulder, takes it over. Well designed that time by UD, as it was Cherry running as the pitch man and Walker getting it in for the two. But it was the combo of Williams and Jefferson. Two big time run, two big time bursts of speed to get that second level. I mean, wow. I mean, just impressive stuff from the Hens.
Two plays, 91 yards, and it took 41 seconds as Delaware has now captured the lead with 6:04 remaining in the third quarter. Delaware Stadium, a great crowd came out to watch on Parents and Family Weekend, and they are rocking here in Newark.
Hadn't had a ton to cheer about offensively. Had plenty on that drive.
Williams and Jefferson combining. Jefferson finished off the drive, his fourth touchdown. of the season. Now McLaughlin will kick it away. It's a good one. Crossing, backpedaling into the end zone. He'll take it out at the 5, middle of the field, at the 10-yard line. He lost the football. Delaware has it. Delaware recovers the football. It's Eric Patton, the hometown hero, giving Delaware the football back.
Vinny Papali or Maurice Harley, one of the 13s out there, couldn't see which one it was, got a piece of the football on the way by. I think it was Harley, just got his fingertip on it and popped it free. Crossen trying to stop and let Harley cross in front of him, and Harley got a piece of Crossen, and a big mistake again on special teams cost New Hampshire dearly in the second half. Lost last week and cost him here on this one.
Momentum on the side of the Blue Hens as they'll start their drive on the New Hampshire 23 with Walker in shotgun. It's Jefferson. Now a reverse. It's Terry. Turns the corner at the 20. Down the sideline at the 10. Cuts it at the 5. Hit from behind and down he goes at the 3-yard line. Delaware rolling right now.
Akeel Anderson chased it down for the backside. They run the end around on the edge, and Cherry just uses his speed. New Hampshire, again, trying to play downhill, everything up. They hand it off to Jefferson. They give it back to Cherry, and he just flat out beat the D end around the edge. Boy, he had a caravan of blockers. That's a great play by Anderson to chase him down from behind and make that stop.
Hens will spread it out. Single back is Williams. First and goal from the 4-yard line. Walker will go to Williams. He makes a cut. Hit at the line of scrimmage. It was Julian Turner who got him down at the 4, maybe 3-yard line. It'll be second and goal to go from that spot.
Kevin McNally had big time penetration initially. Forced the cutback from Williams sooner than he wanted to. And right into a big collision there, center of the field. If you're Delaware, great burst here, but you're in a second down and goal. Got to find a way to cash in and get this to a two-score lead of your own, because the way your defense played, talk about, will Delaware be able to come back from a two-score deficit? I don't know if New Hampshire has it in them either.
Two backs behind Walker. Jefferson and Williams. So go to Williams, running right this time, trying to push his way, but cannot, down at the 1-yard line. And that will be third and goal to go from the 1.
Well, he got a real rough spot. That ball's almost all the way back at the 2. I thought he drove forward and did get to that one, maybe inside the 1. He was hit in the backfield about a yard behind the line of scrimmage and still powered his way forward. Not much push here for the Delaware offensive line on those first 2 plays on goal to go.
Walker will go under center. Williams and Jefferson behind him from the 2. They'll go to Jefferson. Jefferson leans for it and gets it. Thomas Jefferson scores. Delaware 17 unanswered, and they're up 9.
Delaware Stadium's alive again now, isn't it? It was quiet much of the afternoon, but a incredible string of events here from the Hens as they score 2 touchdowns, get a recovered kick fumble, and they do it all in the span of, I think it was 6 plays.
Braga will try the PAT. He missed earlier in the day. Not this time. Delaware up 10. Your PNC Bank timeout score. Delaware 24, New Hampshire 14. 4:06 remaining in the 3rd.
Mom! The weed whacker attacked Dad again.
How bad is...
Kick off for Delaware 39, Kevin McLaughlin.
SD.
blink of an eye, Delaware now up 10, 18 unanswered, kicking this one away. Up 24-14, cross it. He fumbled his last return. Now he has it at the 10 to the 15. Hit hard at Jason Thompson again. His second tackle of the day, both with some force. And the freshman stops New Hampshire at the 15. Let's send it down to the sideline and Michael Atanarase.
Guys, we talked earlier about the offense and defense having a conversation and the offense being quiet. The offense is screaming right now. The two beautiful drives, the return team, the kickoff team setting it up a short field for the offense to score. Offense punching it in with Jefferson. These guys are doing a great job responding. The conversation's going on well now.
And special teams wanted to insert itself in there as well. Say it's a three-way conversation, Mike.
It's a group chat at this point. First and 10 for New Hampshire on their own 15-yard line. Still a lot of football. 4:01 remaining in the third quarter, but Delaware up by 10. 18 unanswered in the third. Dalton Crossan looking for a hole up the middle. Doesn't have much. Picks up maybe three. Bilal Nichols with the tackle.
Well, I tell you what, New Hampshire's third quarter misery continues, though, Scott. It has been a problem for Sean McDonald's team all season long. They have now on the year been outscored 62-14 in the third period, including 18-0 here today. And certainly happy to see that trend move forward.
Goldrich in shotgun form looking for something for this New Hampshire offense. Trips to the right side. Goldrich looking that way. Throws. Batted away. Bilal Nichols gets his hands up. John Nassib was in the area as well. Probably when Nassib is in the area, it's his pass breakup, though, as he's got four on the season. But pressure being applied by Bilal Nichols.
Yeah, Nichols got great push from the front. Nassib on a little twist, got those big long arms up in the air. Boy, if Jay Billis came out and watched a Delaware game, he would love John Nassib with his wingspan, wouldn't he?
We'd all be drinking on a Jay Billis drinking game. He's long, that's for sure. His brother does a nice job at Penn State on the defensive line. Now third down and 6. From the 19 of New Hampshire, Goldrich throwing towards the New Hampshire sideline. High for Taylor. He came down with it, but what, is he in bounds? No, he was not. Pushed out of bounds. Torza was in the area, as was Jackson. And Teddy Anadawusi was there as well. Great coverage. Kion Taylor making some great plays. Fortunately for Delaware, that one out of bounds.
Well, you hit Taylor in the chest, he's got problems, but you throw one up in the air, he'll go get it. He looks like a ballerina going high up there. I don't know how he caught that ball, but give Torres the credit. He was a little late coming over, but he saw the receiver airborne, saw the sideline there, and just nudged him to the boundary. Good defense.
And now with three and out again, Delaware defense doing a nice job. Breda will punt. This one shorter than his others. Got caught up, takes a Delaware bounce from the 47 and rolls out of bounds. We'll see where they mark it around the 35. It'll be at the 35-yard line. That one from the 19 to start. Just a 16-yard punt by Christian Breda. An amazing field position once again for Delaware.
Boy, it's deja vu all over again if you're New Hampshire right now. This is playing out the same way the third and fourth quarter did last week against William & Mary. We talked about how they had a special teams issue, a turnover on special teams that cost them last week. They had that this week. They had a 15-yard punt that led to a touchdown last week. 16-yard punt here. Does it lead to another score?
Now Williams, a single back, as this drive starts in the New Hampshire 35 with 3:07 left in the third quarter. Can Delaware add on to their third quarter total? Not on the first play, as Cam Shuri with a tackle for loss. Williams couldn't get up the field running right. It'll be a loss of 2 on first down.
All season long, the Wildcats have had issues against the run. Delaware has not done much offensively for the first 2.5 quarters. They stuck with it. They had that big burst from Kareem Williams that kind of turned the game around. And now all of a sudden they have New Hampshire kind of back on their heels. Would not be at all surprised if the Hens don't just stick with the ground attack. Dave Brock loves to keep going to it when he thinks he has a defense worn down.
Three wide receivers. One of them's Owen Tyler, split out to the right. They'll keep it on the ground, though. Williams running hard, but into traffic at the 35. Williams up to 116 yards on the day. 84 of them coming on one snap.
But you know that Dave Brock and John Devine are feeling good when you start to see the quarterback line up under center, because most of the time Delaware is a shotgun formation team. But when they start to feel like they're hitting it downhill, they go under center, which is what they did that time. Give credit to New Hampshire, though. They ran a little twist there in the center, got themselves free, and nowhere for Williams to run.
Third down here for Delaware, third down and 10. Hens 50% on third down today. Trips to the right side, and the slot will be Deontay Cherry. The running back is Thomas Jefferson. 1:46 left in the third. And Walker going to throw the football. He does over the middle of the field, incomplete, wide for Riley Angeline. He wanted a flag, didn't get one as Patrick Mensa was in coverage.
Yeah, Angeline really tried hard. He was working to try to draw that fight. He kind of stopped, was running a crossing route, and Mensa did a good job. If he just keeps going, they will throw that flag. But Mensa got his body turned just enough and put the hands up in the air to show the official he was not trying to shove Angeline. That's a good job by Mensa to avoid the penalty.
So we'll see Eric Anderson once again, his feet at the 50-yard line. It's fourth down and 10. Delaware can't take advantage of the great field position to start the drive on the New Hampshire 35. Back to return is DeAndrade. Anderson puts it where Torza can hopefully get to it, saves it at the 1 yard line. I thought Torza was in the end zone when he touched that football, but the ball didn't cross the plane. Excellent play by Torza.
They caught it. Yeah, you're
a little
right
on that call.
Yeah, you're right that he can be in the end zone and tip the ball before it gets into the end zone. I think that ball still broke the plane. The thing you have to wonder about if you're Dave Brock, and I'm sure he's having that discussion with the official right now, is what changed? What changed from when you saw it and didn't call it a touchback right away to what ended up happening? I think the official got it right. He just got it right on like a 5 second delay.
Make your current banking situation simply better with DexDay Federal Credit Union. At DexDay, you receive better service, better rates, and an overall better banking experience. DexDay invites you to open up an account and discover truly free checking with no minimum balance and no monthly fees. Call DexDay at 302-571-0522. First and 10, ball on the 20 for New Hampshire. In motion goes Allison and Goldrich in shotgun form. Going to be a pass from Goldrich. Now he's going to tuck and run as pressure came up the gut. Tinsley with the tackle as Goldrich gets up to the 25, five-yard gain on first down. But great pressure that time for the defensive line of Delaware.
He's a much more assertive runner when he has an opportunity between the tackles. Pocket collapsing from the edge. He tucked immediately and just ran it straight up the gut.
Cross in the back. Four wide receivers, two to both sides on second and five. They swing it to Carlson with some running room. First down at the 30, picking up some more across the 35. Flag thrown as Carlson goes down at the 39-yard line. Ray Jones with a tackle.
Flag came really late, all the way up near the 36-yard line.
Personal foul, flipping. Offense, number 79, 15 yards from the spot of the foul. Second down.
Just an unnecessary penalty that time on Austin Hedder. He did not need to do it. It really wasn't involved in the play. He sprinted out there. It wasn't a true screen, as you called it. I think more it was like a swing pass. And by the time Hedder was able to get out there, he just wasn't in position to make the block and probably should have just tried to let his shifty back do what he could. And Hedder made that clip behind the play. That's really got to be frustrating if you're the UNH staff.
It negates what would have been a first down pickup instead. Second and 10. And Goldrich go back in shotgun form with trips to the right side. Ball on the far side, left hash. Goldrich in shotgun form, looking right, looking to pass, does so. Caught by Taylor at the 25. Down he goes at the 29. It'll be third down and less than a yard for New Hampshire. 26 ticks left in the third quarter.
We just have not seen much tempo today from New Hampshire. They're trying to pick it up and go a little bit faster here, but it's just not the typical Wildcat attack that we've been used to seeing from this UNH program over the last decade.
New Hampshire needs a yard. They're just 2 of 12 on third down. Allison in motion. Goldrich will keep it himself. Gets around two Delaware defenders. Picks up the first. He got by Spears and Bell. Hard to do. Ray Jones made the stop at the 34. And that will end the third quarter of action. Delaware 18 unanswered to start the third quarter. We'll head to the fourth when we come back. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 24, New Hampshire 14.
Value days are
a play launcher. Special thanks to Adidas, the official outfitter of University of Delaware Athletics. Adidas is proud to outfit Delaware Athletics in the best performance apparel.
DSD, I'm Scott Klatskin alongside Matt Janis, Michael Anrasse down on the field. James Taylor producing on site and Michael Diodati down on the field. Fourth quarter about to start with Delaware up 24-14. Let's get you quickly some stats in this one. Individually, Kareem Williams, 115 yards rushing on the day on 13 carries. Thomas Jefferson, 14 carries for 67 yards, three touchdowns for Jefferson. Through the air, Joe Walker, 6 of 10, 62 yards for New Hampshire. Goldridge, 13 of 26, 106 yards and a touchdown. Don't cross it, 10 carries, 24 yards for New Hampshire. Jared Allison, 5 catches, 24 and a touchdown for New Hampshire. Looking at the total offense for both teams, 156 for New Hampshire, 283 for the Delaware Bluehead.
I mean, statistically, Delaware has dominated this game. New Hampshire has not been able to run the football at all. Hens have done a great job keeping Crossan in check. Of course, he had the big fumble on that kickoff return, which set up one of the touchdowns. You still have to be wary of Sean Goldridge, though. He's a guy with so much experience, and he can get hot in this fourth quarter. He has struggled. He has not played well. He's completing just 50% of his passes. He's thrown a pick, just one touchdown, only 106 yards passing. But if you let him get into any type of rhythm like we saw at the end of the first half, he can hurt you.
He's not at quarterback right now. Trevor Knight will start the fourth quarter at the QB position, and he'll keep it on the ground. He's stopped for a short game by Grant Roberts, dove his way to the 38 on first and 10, a pickup of four.
Yeah, I don't get it. I mean, you started to get into some type of a rhythm offensively. You've had none all day long, and then you try the gadget play. Sometimes you can be too smart for your own good.
They'll do it again as Goldrich in the slot on the near side left. Trevor Knight is the quarterback again. Design keep fools no one, and three blue jerseys stop him at the line of scrimmage, including Bilal Nichols, who might have got there first.
Unless you're trying to set something up, it just doesn't make any sense to me. I think Ryan Carty's a smart coach. I think Ryan Carty is a guy who's going to be a head coach here much sooner rather than later. But in this spot, in such an important possession, surprised that they went to it there.
We know he got a good education, at least, so he has
to be
a smart football guy. Ryan Carty, offensive coordinator, former captain of 2006 Blue Hens team. Third down and six for New Hampshire. Goldrich back into the quarterback spot at his own 38. He sends Tyler in motion. Tyler will catch the football at the 40, and Ray Jones does not let him get much further than that. At the 41, he's pushed out. It'll be fourth down for New Hampshire.
Oh, big decision here. It's fourth and manageable. They gave him all the way to the 42, but you're on your own side of the field, and that is a sign that not a ton of faith shown right now in your offense. If you're Delaware, this is a safety situation here. Yeah, you don't want to do anything that would risk letting New Hampshire pick something up if they go fake.
Christian Breida will be back to punt it away. Fourth down and two from the New Hampshire 42. Terry back to return. Breida with his feet at the 27-yard line, catches it, and he'll punt it away. It's high. Terry waits for it. Signals for the fair catch at the 23-yard line with 13:29 left in the game. A 35-yard punt by Christian Breda, and the Delaware offense will come back onto the field. What a third quarter of action it was, Matt. We were looking for some excitement, and then Kareem Williams goes 84 yards. Very next play, Thomas Jefferson gets it through, and a special teams play. It was the most exciting third quarter we've had all season.
It was. That was a boring first half, and it was more than made up by for the third quarter. And I'm not a guy who is opposed to low-scoring defensive football. It just, nothing was happening. Everybody was running the ball on pretty much every play, and it was all 2-3 yard pickups and then send the punt unit out. Then all of a sudden, Kareem Williams changed everything with that one big burst getting to the second level. And all you know what broke loose from there.
Thomas Jefferson will be the running back to start this drive for Delaware in shotgun form, and Jefferson will get the football, trying to turn the corner, running as wide as he can to the right side, and it brought down eventually at the 23-yard line by number 23, Dougie Maul.
Hey, be careful here. If you're Delaware, you haven't won anything yet. I mean, you cannot just relax and figure 10-point lead with the way our defense is playing is good enough. That's exactly probably what William and Mary was thinking 3 weeks ago here at Delaware Stadium when the Tribe came back on the Hens. So that's a teaching point for Dave Brock. You know, you've won nothing yet. Don't be satisfied. Stick with trying to make something happen.
Second and 11 for Delaware as they try to make something happen with 12:48 remaining in the fourth quarter, a 24-14 lead. Williams goes in motion. Up the gut goes Thomas Jefferson, keeping it on the ground. And he dives forward to the 27-yard line. It'll be third down for Delaware as Daniel Rowe came in. And Hayden Hudson was there again.
Did they call timeout? What in the New Hampshire? Sean McDonald's a smart guy. I respect him as much as any coach in the CAA. And I think sometimes that he really is unfairly, he loses some credit because he found Chip Kelly. But you got to remember that Chip Kelly left after 06. And they then proceeded to make the playoffs for, what, the next 8 years, 9 years after that. So a lot more of the streak of consecutive postseason appearances came after Chip Kelly left than came when Chip Kelly was on New Hampshire's staff. And I understand that 40 seconds now is the same as 40 seconds later in the game, but there's 12:36 left in the fourth quarter. Who knows what happens from here? Perhaps he wanted to make sure his defense gets a stop, and he figures, why waste any time in the process of doing that? Let's bring him over and discuss something. Maybe he thinks he knows what play Delaware has up their sleeve on this third and long. That might be something you want to discuss with your team before they go back out on the field, though. Not to burn a timeout at this stage is strange. That's really weird.
It is an odd time to call a timeout on third and seven for Delaware at their own 27. McDonald, very successful, 129-76 in his career with New Hampshire. His timeout does give me an opportunity to remind our listeners that at St. Francis Healthcare, they get their emergency patients out of the waiting room and into treatment fast, averaging a wait time of less than 32 minutes. And stroke and heart attack patients are seen immediately. At St. Francis, you'll find that fast, exceptional treatment is the rule, not the exception. So you get the care you need right when you need it. St. Francis Healthcare, they treat your emergency with urgency. After the odd timeout by Sean McDonald and this New Hampshire defense, Delaware comes out with an empty backfield, five wide on third down and seven from their own 24. Quick pass and a tight spiral caught by Cherry for a first down on the slant out to the 35.
Well, they brought a blitz untouched up the A-gap. McNally and Walker just hangs in there and knows the read. He sees where the football is supposed to go. Center of the field is vulnerable. That's where the blitz came from. Accurate toss to Cherry under heavy duress. Good job by Walker. That timeout not looking so good for McDonald now.
You think Walker's excited to have Deontay Cherry back, the only guy coming into the year at the wide receiver spot with any career receptions. That's his third of the day, and it's a big one. First and 10 for Delaware at their own 36. They'll go back to the ground game. Jefferson nearly tripped up in the backfield, stumbles across the line of scrimmage, and gets all the way out to the 38-yard line, a pickup of two. Looks like Julian Turner, the last one to get up out of the pocket.
Tell you what, though, the first down pickup allows you to burn another 2 minutes off the clock, which is important in this situation, up by 10. Just trying to get the first downs. Now, if you're Delaware, clock certainly your friend, and long that offense can stay out there. The way your defense is played, at this point, you've already flipped the field, which is really the first thing that you wanted to accomplish on this drive.
And we'll see how that burn timeout plays a part later in this game for New Hampshire. Second down and 8 for the Delaware 38-yard line. Walker back under center. Single back is Thomas Jefferson. Jefferson gets another carry, hit at the 40-yard line. Dragged back, but they'll mark him at the 40. It'll be third down and 6 for Delaware as Julian Turner in again on the tackle.
I mean, remember, he saved the 40 seconds by calling the timeout, but it's almost a mental thing that you like to have those timeouts in your back pocket when you're trying to come from behind. It keeps everybody feeling like there's still so much better of a chance to be able to rally back. Right now, if you're New Hampshire, the focus has to turn to getting off the field on third down. Clutch pickup by the Hens on the previous possession. This is a manageable spot. They trusted Walker to throw it. He came through the last time.
Delaware up 24-14, 10:39 remaining in the ball game. Two tight end set. Ricky Bell in the slot on the left side of the field. Walker going to tuck, run it himself. Trying to find a hole. Does so. First down, Joe Walker with his feet. To the 48-yard line, a designed run for the freshman quarterback, and they move the chains.
Thomas, Jefferson, and Connor Bozick both threw great blocks on the right side, and then Joe Walker pretty much did the rest. Jefferson comes up as a lead backer. He got the linebacker, and then Bozick got a big shot on Akeel Anderson, who's been such a thorn at Delaware's side against the run all day long. Great execution by the Hens, and then the shiftiness of Walker helped move the sticks.
Walker led the team in rushing a week ago with 76 yards, 28 yards today for Walker, who goes under center, first and 10 from the Delaware 48. Two tight ends in the ballgame. They'll go to Jefferson. Starts left, cuts it back, stiff arm, and down he goes into New Hampshire territory at the 46. DeAndre made the stop, but Jefferson roughed him up a bit on his way down to the turf.
This is the cumulative effect of Delaware's downhill style. You got a run defense that's pretty poor as it is, and now they've been on the field for much of this second half, and they have taken shot after shot from this powerful front line of Delaware, and they just seem a little worn down right now.
Walker takes a knee in the huddle as he talks with his team, not in a rush. 12 seconds on the play clock. Second and four coming up from the New Hampshire 46-yard line. Single back remains Jefferson. Two wide receivers to the right side. Bell and Jarman split out to left is Cherry. They'll keep it on the ground. It's Jefferson using some blocking to get close to a first down yardage. Maybe a half of a yard shy. It'll be third and close with 9 minutes left in the fourth.
Feel pretty good about this spot right now if you're Delaware. The odds certainly seem against New Hampshire picking up or being able to stop the Hens on two straight plays, although a Delaware O-lineman down as the pile got up, and I don't think it's Will Lewis is the guy that couldn't get up.
Will Lewis, that's the third game he's gone down. He went down in the North Carolina game last week against Rhode Island, and you could see some frustration as he pounds the turf, upset that he's injured once again. He's just had a hard time getting healthy. He's been great when he has been healthy, but right now being checked on at around that 43-yard line. 8:54 left to play in this game. Delaware up by 10, 24-14. They trailed 14-6 going into the locker room. And as there's a break in action, let's get you a Glasgow Medical 8 Units scoreboard update, looking at some scores around the CAA.
Well, maybe ESPN wishes they would have put that JMU game on. They were there for game day earlier in the afternoon, and it has been a flat-out thriller in Harrisonburg. 10 minutes to go in the third quarter. JMU 35, Richmond 35, as Will Lewis is up under his own power, walking off the field, which is a good sign for UD. But what a game there as the undefeated Dukes tied with the one-loss Spiders. Still plenty of time left to go. Meanwhile, late third quarter down at Williamsburg, the Tribe 37, as William & Mary leads Hampton 37-7. And earlier today, Maine beat Stony Brook 23-10.
Will Lewis to the sideline, not going too far, it looks. Third down and one for Delaware. In motion goes Owen Tyler, and a false start against Delaware.
Offense. 5-yard penalty, third down.
Just cannot afford an unforced error in that spot. Third and downhill. It's Jake Drump, the guilty party. Gotta hold your water in that spot. Obviously, a lot easier for us to say it up here, but boy, that's a spot you could not afford a penalty like that.
It was less than a yard for Delaware to get the first down. Now third down and six. Second penalty against Jake Trump in this game. And now Walker will approach his center, Brody Curd, with two tight ends. Single back is Jefferson, two wide receivers to the left. Jefferson gonna run for it. And just shy of the first down at the 44-yard line. Looked like he had a hole that closed very quickly as Akeel Anderson came through to make the stop. Another timeout taken by New Hampshire.
What are you going to do here if you're Dave Brock? How aggressive do you want to be? It's fourth down and two. You have had a phenomenal effort from your defense all day long. Just the first drive of the game when you gave UNH a short field and the last drive of the first half. But if you pump the football here, it's a two-score lead. You try to force UNH to go the length of the field, and you play field position. That's the prudent, high-percentage thing to do. But you're a young program trying to forge that identity. You want to be a line-of-scrimmage team. You're facing one of the worst run defenses in the country, certainly in the conference. You leave your offense on the field and try to make that statement by converting, getting the first down here. I think you do if you're Dave Brock. It's easy to second guess if it doesn't work, but I think you're trying to, this is big picture more than it is just trying to win this football game. I mean, if you don't get it, it's not an automatic loss. You're still up by 10, and New Hampshire's only got about 8 minutes to go.
Mike Anrasse is down on the sideline. What are you thinking here?
I believe they go for it. I looked at Coach Brock, his mannerisms, his body language. He's leaving the offense on the field. Guys, this is not so much a test on how much he trusts his offense. It's how much he trusts his defense, too. He believes if he doesn't get the first down right there, the defense could stand up and stop UNH with good field position.
Well, you're right on that call, Michael and Matt, as the offense will stay on the field. They'll keep it tight on fourth down and two. Far side hash at the New Hampshire 44-yard line, up by 10, 24-14. New Hampshire with one timeout left, coming off of a timeout. It's fourth down and two. Two players go in motion for Delaware. Yoakum retreats to the left, and New Hampshire move. Hard count.
Uh-oh, wait.
And New Hampshire looked like they jumped.
Umpire was signaling false start. Did Delaware squeeze the football? Was it a simulated snap? Line's been had offsides.
Contact.
Yes.
90. Defense.
There it is.
5-yard penalty. First down.
And that's the right call because I thought that the nose tackle moved. But the umpire started signaling false start, and a linesman came in and called the umpire to the huddle. And luckily for Delaware, the linesman won the huddle, the argument.
Delaware picks up the first down, and with 8:11 remaining in the fourth, up by 10. It'll be first and 10 for Delaware at the New Hampshire 39-yard line. Walker is the quarterback. Jefferson still the back. Two tight ends in, offset eye. Yoakum changes from left to right. They'll go to Jefferson, going to the right. And wrapped up across the 40 down to the 38-yard line. Looked like Ryan Farrell and Akeel Anderson combined for the stop.
Now it's just about clock, though. The clock is such an ally at this point because of those timeouts used by UNH. They have just one remaining. And you just want to keep moving it if you're Delaware. And certainly you'd like to keep picking up first downs, but just keep the ball on the ground. You're going to be able to run it under 6 minutes to go. And if you're UNH at this point, you're looking best case scenario, probably needing a touchdown and then an onside kick just to have a shot. That's if you stop Delaware here.
Single backs, Jefferson. Jefferson posted 90 yards on the day. Williams already over 100. Jefferson wrapped up by Shorey as he gets close to a first down at the 31-yard line. So again, third down and they give it to him at the 33, it looks like. I thought he was a little closer. But still, third down and short here for Delaware, and the clock runs.
I think they're going to split the difference for you and go 32, but either way, it's still third down and two plays to pick up these 3 yards or 2.5 yards, whatever you want to call it. And that was a great move by Jefferson. A little jump cut there and slithered to the outside and got him a couple of extra yards. Every yard counts right now.
We're under 7 to play here in the fourth. Delaware trailed 14-6 at the break. They now lead 24-14. Walker, shotgun form, going to keep it himself. Running to the right side, cuts it a little bit, and now stays up as he gets to the 30-yard line. Inside the 30, down at the 28-yard line. What an effort by Joe Walker. And he might have picked up the first.
Oh, he did. He got it with a yard to spare. Unbelievable play by Joe Walker. He was bottled up not once, but twice in the backfield. He slithered left, then he jumped forward, broke a tackle, used his power to get all the way to the 28. Incredible play by a quarterback. Most running backs wouldn't have been able to get out of that situation. Wow.
That's Joe Walker. Great runner, showing it there. And now he goes under center as tick-tock goes the clock to 6:10. Ends up by 10. It's Jefferson. Starts left. Good pressure by the New Hampshire defense, stopping him at the 29-yard line. It was Akeel Anderson again in on the tackle.
Now you're going to be able to run it all the way to 4 minutes. You're up by 2 scores. Your opponent has just one timeout. If you don't pick up another first down, they probably use a timeout after third down. So it's about 4:15 you're looking or so at the earliest New Hampshire can get the football back. What a drive by UD. I mean, just phenomenal to have an opponent know this is what you're going to do. I know it's not a very good run defense, but it's still one of the better programs in this conference. It's a big step forward for Brock's team.
Delaware up to 259 rushing in this game, above their season average. And now Jefferson trying to add to it. Akeel Anderson not letting go. Dragged him down by his right leg. And at the 28, that's where New Hampshire will call the timeout. It'll be third down and long this time for Delaware. This is the final timeout
called by New Hampshire. This timeout allows me a chance to let our listeners know that our business of the week is Horizon Services. They're the industry leader. With over 200 trucks on the road, they can get to your home right away. You can schedule an appointment to fit your schedule any time of day and on weekends. With the weather turning colder, now is a great time to have your heater serviced. They can take care of any make or model. They have all the parts in stock and the best trained technicians in the business. You can rest assured your tech will be on time and be respectful of you and your home. Call today, 442-7607, or visit horizonservices.com.
Now, the Hens have five and just over a quarter minutes remaining in this football game. New Hampshire has no timeouts. Delaware has a 10-point lead. It is third and 10 from inside the 30. You could run for 5-6 yards and get into Frank Grago's field goal range, but I got a feeling this is two runs here for Delaware. You certainly are running the football to run the clock after third down, and I think you're keeping your offense on the field to see what happens on fourth.
They'll start in shotgun form on third and 10. It's Williams, fresh legs, and he stays on his feet, spinning off tacklers and inside the 10-yard line, down to the 6. Kareem Williams with the big carry, and the first down for Delaware.
If you're Jaywan Horton, you're going to be dying. You were in position to make the stop. You fought off the block, and you wrapped Williams up. But Kareem Williams, deceptively strong. Looked like his brother that time. He says, I'm a speed back, not a power back. Well, he was a power back that time. Between the tackles, spun right off the arm. Tackle ran through it. And then the balance to stay on his feet instead of falling forward for 6 or 7, go all the way inside the 10.
Walker will be in shotgun from the 6. First and goal to go. Kareem Williams on the carry, upended at the line of scrimmage. Maybe lost one. But the clock continuing to run. No timeouts left for New Hampshire, and Delaware in great position to put this one away.
And protecting the football is top priority. Touchdown certainly ends it because it gets it to a 3-score game. But we're pretty close to that as it is. You just do not want to turn the football over here if you're UD.
4:10 and ticking as Walker taking his time getting to the huddle. They break huddle with 10 on the play clock. Single back is Thomas Jefferson. Ball on the near side hash. Second and goal to go from the 6. Walker to Jefferson. Looking for a lane. Gets down to the 2-yard line. And the Hens will have it third and goal to go. Under 4 to play, up by 10.
Boy, Akil Anderson, good tackle that time. He's been the only New Hampshire defender that you've really feared all day long. Everybody else, Delaware's been able to control. They've been able to run through tackles. Anderson's been pretty sure all afternoon. That was a good cut by Jefferson. It looked like it was going to escape Anderson's grasp, but give the linebacker credit for holding on. But meanwhile, that clock just keeps burning away.
This coming up will be the 18th play of this drive. Amazing for Delaware. They've got a third and goal to go. Jefferson and Williams behind Walker. It'll be Williams sprinting for the end zone and putting this game away. Delaware up 30-14 late in the fourth.
The expression, using its strength to exploit a weakness. Delaware has done that in the second half. Credit to Sean Devine. Credit to Dave Brock. It wasn't a pretty first half, but they know the identity of this football team. It is to run the football. It is to control the line of scrimmage. You have to stay patient as a coaching staff, though, if you're going to do it. They stuck with it. And boy, did they ever execute here in this second half.
Frank Rago, extra point up and through. Your PNC Bank timeout score, Delaware 31, New Hampshire 14, 309 left from Delaware State.
For over 38 years, Brandywine Electronics has been a reliable asset to the Delaware Valley audiovisual community. BEL is known for the highest level of quality audio services for special events, installation, and service needs. BEL AV designs can be found in boardrooms, classrooms, stadiums, and restaurants across the area. What did the University of Delaware, Point to Point, the Polar Bear Plunge, AAA, President Bush, and President Clinton all have in common? They were all powered by Brandywine Electronics. Visit BEL.com for more information.
At Domino's, choose any two medium, two-topping pizzas, pasta in a dish, sandwich, cheesy bread, or eight-piece wings or specialty chicken, and both are just $5.99 each. Visit Domino's.com.
See what's out there in the 2016 Chevy Trax. It's City Smart, more than you expect for less than you imagine. Find yours at your local Chevy dealer.
You're listening to UD Football on 94.7 WDSD.
Where goes 18 plays, 76 yards, and takes up 10:20 of the fourth quarter clock to go up 31-14 against New Hampshire. Kareem Williams' three-yard run seals what will be a victory for Delaware. McLaughlin will squib this one away to New Hampshire with 3:09 on the clock as Dalton gets it to the 17. Now 25-30 down the sideline, shoved out at around the 34-yard line. What a second half of football. I can't wait for Michael Attenrasse to talk with Dave Brock after this one. As they responded, answered in the second half, and still went with their bread and butter, running the football, picking up first downs on that final drive, nearly 300 yards on the ground, 288 on 52 carries for Delaware.
Outrushing New Hampshire, 288 to 50 today. It's a testament to both sides of the ball. The type of program Dave Brock wants to bring here to Delaware. It's taken a little longer than he would have wanted maybe, and then certainly I think some of the folks here at Delaware would have wanted, but he's getting there.
Goldrich throwing far side of the field, diving forward and catching it at the 40-yard line is Jared Allison. Clock running at 2:55.
Man, just pushed New Hampshire. It's a good program. Pushed them around. I know they're not typical New Hampshire. It's a bad run defense. There's no doubt about it. But they still out-physical them from start to finish.
Goldrich wants to throw again. Will caught by Goodrich at the 45-yard line. Teniatawusi with the tackle, and that'll be a first down for New Hampshire. This is going to be the first time New Hampshire has lost back-to-back games in the CAA since 2010. This New Hampshire team has been the model of success, and I don't care what the year, any win against New Hampshire is a great win. First and 10 as Goldrich slings it to Jordan Powell, and Anthony Jackson got his hand on it, breaks that one away.
It's a little surprising, too, with this New Hampshire team's got, because it felt like they were building towards finally having success in the postseason. I think they went all in last year, and they had that back-breaking collapse of the semifinals. They had a big lead, couldn't hold on to it, and they lost so many bodies, particularly playmakers on the offensive end. But you just kind of figured they'd still figure out a way, because they always do. But Delaware kind of slamming the door shut on them tonight.
Goldrich, pressure coming, rolls, has somebody in the flat. It's caught at the 50 by Goodrich, and he's dragged down.
They just
look like Watson.
They just don't have playmakers. I mean, it's amazing. There's not much speed. I know Delaware's really fast, but this New Hampshire offense is making Delaware look like a bunch of sprinters. I mean, it's unbelievable how much faster Delaware is to the football, to the edge, to the angle, across the board.
31-14 Delaware lead as Goodrich throws it. Goldrich, excuse me. Passes looking for Allison, knocked away, batted down at around the 45 in Delaware territory. What a win for this Delaware ball club. Down 14-6 at the half, and to respond in a quarter where they had been outscored by a heavy margin throughout the season, to have an answer against a good Wildcat football team. This team responds so well at home.
Especially after the body blow they received at the end of the half, that long drive by New Hampshire to get into the end zone and take that 8-point lead and all the momentum, and then you go three and out to start the second half.
Fourth down and 6 for New Hampshire. Goldrich throws to Allison, some room to run at the 50. Watson brings him down in space, and a turnover on downs will give it to Delaware, and they'll be able to run out the clock.
They just don't miss tackles. I mean, he's in space one-on-one with Watson. Not only does Watson slow him down and help the cavalry alive, he goes ahead and makes a tackle himself. I mean, he squares him up. That's probably New Hampshire's second-best playmaker right there, and could not shake free of Watson with about 15 yards of space to operate. To the right, to the left, nobody else in the vicinity. I mean, it's an incredible step forward that this Delaware defense has made, and now they get the funnest formation in football.
The victory formation for Delaware. 1:53 left, but no timeouts for New Hampshire, as Walker will take the first knee. Delaware, 288 yards rushing, 140 of them came from Kareem Williams. His 84-yard run sent up the first touchdown of the second half. Thomas Jefferson, 98 yards. Maybe give it to Jefferson. one time. See if he can get 2 yards. If not, I'm happy with the win.
I think Tom will be fine with it as well, as will Williams. I mean, it just the wave of freshness that you can throw back there. And remember, Wes Hills is coming back next year. Jalen Randolph's probably coming back next week. You're going to have quite the log jam at running back. It's a good problem to have.
Joe Walker will take another knee. He'll have to do it one more time. Kareem Williams, 16 carries, 140 yards, a touchdown, averaged almost 9 yards per carry in this one. Jefferson, as I just mentioned, 26 carries, 98 yards, 3 touchdowns. Joe Walker got 31 yards, but they were some big runs in this game as he picked up several first downs with great efforts. And now under 40 seconds, this will be the final knee of the game. Delaware in victory formation, Joe Walker. Joe Walker takes the snap, kneels, and Delaware hands New Hampshire back-to-back conference losses for the first time since 2010. Delaware wins 31-14 over the Wildcats. We'll have plenty of post-game coverage here at Delaware Stadium. It's all coming up in the American Spirit Federal Credit Union post-game show. We'll have final stats for you. Matt and I will recap. Michael Attanrasse will talk with head coach Dave Brock and our player of the game, Kareem Williams, who went over 140 or went for 140 yards on the ground. What an afternoon into night here at Delaware Stadium. Big crowd on hand to watch the Blue Hens for parents and family weekend, and they did not disappoint.
How many times have we been talking about Delaware needs good fortune to come together to try to get this thing rolling again? Because they've had good wins in the Dave Brock era, but they've come on the road, but they've come in inclement weather, and you just wanted everybody in the vicinity to get a chance to see this team and see that they're more fun to watch now. They really are. They have come so far. Their record is going to end up being worse this year than it was last year. Probably, maybe not. Maybe they get on a run here late. But the level of football, it's not even close. And, I mean, they still have a lot of issues to get squared away. I mean, you're not going to beat elite football teams being completely one-dimensional. They were balanced just enough today to be able to take advantage of a UNH team that can't stop the run if they save their life. But to be opportunistic the way Delaware was, to break off the big plays, to not get down, considering the adversity that you faced 2 weeks ago against URI with that horrid loss, and then in the first half against William & Mary, you give them a short field on the first play, and you try an onside kick that doesn't work. You go down 7-0 in the blink of an eye. You're down 14-6 at the half. They just aren't bothered by that kind of stuff. They just kind of knock it off their shoulder and keep plowing ahead. And to their credit, I mean, they won this game going away. It's a good win. It's a building block. It's that thing we were talking about in the pregame show. Something positive to gravitate towards that shows you what's waiting down the line, hopefully.
Even more impressive, and I know talking about how youthful this team is gets old because we use it as an excuse, and then when it's good for Delaware, we use it as a point of amazement. But I am impressed by all those things that you mentioned, how well they stay in the games, are able to bounce back and play well despite having such a young football
See,
team.
To me, talking about how young they are gets old when you lose. When you win,
it's impressive.
Talk about how young you are, you get excited because you're like, hey, a lot of these guys are going to be here for 2 or 3 more years. You can see what you're building towards. But again, that's what you were talking about. At a certain point, you needed to see something positive happen that you felt like you could build for. You thought you had that with William & Mary, but I think it was kind of wiped away with what happened at Rhode Island. And now you're trying to figure out, wait, what is this football team? They're not there yet. Don't get me wrong. There's still a lot of work left to be done, a lot of pieces that have to be filled in. But big step forward, something you can build on, and you can see what is possible. You're still going to get there, but there's a high expectation going into next year, and there's still a lot of football left to keep building your way towards it this season.
And, Matt, we talked about which team would show up. We want to know which team. Would it be the William & Mary team, the team that beat William & Mary, the team that lost to Rhode Island today? We know which team showed up at Delaware Stadium, the team that beat New Hampshire 31-14. We're going to send it down to the field, and Michael Attanrasse, he's got head coach Dave Brock. This interview brought to you by the UD Part-Time MBA. Want to advance your full-time career? A UD Part-Time MBA may be what you need. The UD MBA offers unmatched online and on-campus flexibility. Move your full-time career ahead with a UD Part-Time MBA. Visit udmba.com. Michael, take it away.
Hey, Coach, great second half. Talk to me about the response that this young team put up in the second half.
Well, I felt like we knew we had some things, and we were just close in the first half offensively. We were playing lights out on defense. You know, we took a shot. As a team, we made a decision to take that shot to start the game. You know, we were all in, and it didn't work out. But the kids never flinched. You know, they came out in the second half, played really, really hard. We got the run game going, made some big, big-time throws and catches, which we've struggled to do. Cracked a big one, you know, an 80-yard run, whatever it is. I thought for a second Kareem was going to score, but, you know, we'll work on his speed in the offseason. Just very excited for the players. I mean, great resolve. You know, we got the right men in that locker room. There's no doubt about that. And really, really excited.